I'm sorry, should I do a do-over?
Start from the beginning.
Start from the beginning, I will do that, okay. Yes. Hi, good evening. Hello, I'm City Council President Bill Dwight. Welcome to the Northampton City Council meeting of December 3rd, 2015. I am the presiding officer here. And before we convene, I'm inviting the public to speak as per our custom. We have a public comment session that precedes each meeting, and we ask that everyone keep their comments under 3 minutes, that they respect the decorum of the chamber, and do not speak ill of other people who are among, you can speak ill of us, and you can speak ill of other political elected officials. That's, you're perfectly welcome to do that, and I don't blame you. But we also ask that you understand that the council is precluded by our rules from responding. So if you ask a question, it will stand as a rhetorical question. It's not that we're ignoring you, it's just the fact that we're precluded by rules from actually speaking. It's your turn to speak. You are not limited to subject matter either. It doesn't have to be, and you're not even limited to the fact that if you're not a Northampton resident. So, with all those caveats in place, when I call your name, please step up and then restate your name and your address for the record. And we'll start. First up, we have Natalia Munoz.
Good evening, thank you. I wish to speak well of the City Council. I am so glad to live in Northampton, that I have a City Council like this, that is proactive, that takes on controversial issues and takes stands that, well, I think they're great because I agree with them, but for instance, on the Syrian refugees, I think it's a very important statement to make that they are welcome in Northampton. And I'm really proud that you are my city councilors and you're going to be considering this resolution. And also on the domestic violence issue, also, that is so important in that it's not just a, we support, you know, people who are working to, you know, with people who are the victims of domestic violence, but it's actionable, it's raising awareness, and that's so important. And I'm really glad you're all doing that, and I wanted to thank you for that.
Thank you very much. Deborah Martinez, please.
Good evening. I live on 29 Elm Street. I've owned property here for 16 years, and my children graduated from school here. They finished college here, and they have jobs here. And I love being here. Otherwise, I wouldn't live here. I'm just concerned about certain things, mostly financial aspect of the whole situation. I know that it's important to help people. My father was a World War II veteran. He passed away this past year, and he was 97 years old. He used to talk about what happened during World War II in Europe and what he saw and how we Americans couldn't really help that many people and how horrible it was. So I grew up listening to that, and I know that it's important to help other people. Everybody's great-grandmother was born somewhere else, so there's not, you know, something that is something foreign. Whoever thinks that we're American, sure, we're lucky. We were born and raised and educated here. But everybody's family came from somewhere else. That's how it is. So I know it's important to help people. I'm just concerned about the situation financially. Children come in from other places, and we need to hire ESL teachers because they don't know any English, no nurses, you know, medical, housing, many, many services that many of them probably never even went to school because they live in a war zone. And that war has gone for many years and it's gonna continue. We like to help everybody, but we cannot help every, you know, we cannot solve their problems. I'm just worried about financially, how are we going to help the situation? I know that with my taxes, I pay for beautifying Northampton and I like it, it's nice. But maybe we should consider, instead of spending money in parks and other things, to have a savings account on the town in case we have a situation like this that we could say, well, you know what? I have an extra $10 million in a special account that I could help this project or this situation. It's just a matter of numbers because all things have to come from somewhere. And it's important that we look at the financial aspect. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Sally Weiss, please.
Hi. I think most people know me as an anti-war activist. And
Sally, you'll have to state your name and address, please.
Oh, Sally Weiss, 38 Fort Street, Northampton. I'm here to second the motion of how proud I am of Northampton. The National Peace Movement, which I'm also in, not just the vigil. I think there's five of us in this room that are active members of the vigil that happens on the corner of King and Main every Saturday. But the National Peace Movement has been taking note of course, how Congress is acting about refugees. And we're very unhappy about it. And what we have figured out is it's going to take communities and to invite refugees. If you recall, Amherst invited two Guantanamo refugees and never could, they're not refugees, prisoners. And they were never able to get those two Uyghurs into Amherst. But, you know, in our valley, we really stand for, we have a foreign policy for one thing, right? Amherst and Northampton. And I just want to amplify the numbers in the sense that Syrians are not the only refugees in the world. In the whole world, there's about 11 or 12 million refugees. And I don't know if everyone in this room knows, but the United States of America at the most is talking about 10,000. There's a leader of, there's a person in DC that's a pundit, I guess you'd say, on the left. And she says we have, the United States has 28% of the world's resources. Therefore, we should have 28% of the responsibility for these 11, 12 million, or at least the ones in Syria. And we should also be contributing 28% to their finance. And it'll be, I don't think the city itself is saying that they will finance these refugees, but I would stand on the way of, I'd have bake sales or whatever it's going to take to make this happen. I'm just very proud. This is how it can happen. This is how we buck the fear that's been instilled in us about Middle Eastern people, that, you know, they're all Muslims and some fair percentage of them are terrorists. I mean, it's just, this has swept our country. It's terrible. And just thank you, Northampton.
Thank you very much. Christine, I'm going to slaughter your name. It's okay.
Martis is my maiden name. Christine Martis Parmentier is the married name.
Thank you.
My name is Christine Martis Parmentier. I live in South Hadley, Massachusetts. I am here regarding a situation with the Peter and Paul Russian Cemetery, which is on Mountain Street in Florence. This cemetery was established by my grandfather and many other Russian immigrants who came to this country, and of course some of them started to pass away and needed a place to rest their dead. The land was purchased in 1929 for $1. At this time, the reason why I'm here is because we are receiving a bill for currently for $142.73 for what is called a storm water. I'm not totally familiar with it. I did pull it up on the website and did read about it to protect Northampton from further flood if there is to be a flood. At this point in time, Peter and Paul Russian Cemetery is not an active cemetery, meaning we're active in burying people, but we do not sell plots, we do not sell graves, we are just burying people that already have graves there. So we have no income and we have no expenses. Therefore, we have no perpetual care fund to pay this bill. I'm here basically to state that I feel that a cemetery does not have any runoff. It is totally pervious, so any rain, pour a cup of water, you water your plants, it goes down into the ground, it hits the vaults. Doesn't hit anything else. It helps the grass grow and we have to mow it. Basically, there should be an exception regarding cemeteries and such as ours where we do not have any income nor do we have any expenses. So that is why I'm here this evening, and I hope that the City Council will take this into consideration. I know this is brand new as of last year's or this year's fiscal year, and that, you know, cemeteries such as ours can be excluded since we do not have the funds to pay for this. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Harriet Brickman, please.
I'm Harriet Brickman from 53 Bottoms Road, which is the farm at the end of the road, and I'm here to ask you to reconsider your vote on Bottoms Road as a public way. I know I'm late to the table, and I apologize for that, but when Ned Huntley showed us the plan that you saw in October, he showed it to us in January, last January 26th. It was the last iteration of many plans, which was the result of many meetings at the DPW, both with the board and with the staff and with the neighborhood. And we were told that we would be notified when this was going to go before the City Council, and I only found out a couple days before Thanksgiving from my neighbor that you had already voted on it twice. So the plan that was put before you at your October meeting is the plan that is amenable to all the users of the road. It looks at only the common portion of Bottoms Road and builds off of that. It's amenable for many more reasons than I'm going to state in my 3 minutes here, but I do want to mention one, which is that Bottoms Road is a watershed for a large section of Florence. So when the road washes out, and it's not if, it's when, it has happened before and it will happen again, all of it goes to the center of the Clement Street Bridge, making Clement Street impassable as well as Bottoms Road. So this is a civic issue much larger than public-private way. And I hope you will reconsider your last vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Tom Reardon.
Good evening. I'm Tom Reardon. I also live at 53 Bottoms Road. And I just heard today, actually, I know I've been somewhat negligent in my civic duties to keep up with online media and how everyone gets notified of these things. But as of almost a year ago now, we had sort of thought that this was pretty much resolved with both the DPW and the BPW before it became, a jurisdiction of the City Council, where we would talk with, like Harriet had said, we had talked with all the neighbors, and we had talked with Ned, and we had worked out what was the best arrangement so that only the common use part of Bottoms Road would be considered for the city to be taking it. And we were all pretty much in agreement and thought it was all going forward. And so I was surprised to hear that on the second vote that it was rejected. I don't think I have much more to add than what Harriet said, except that I think everyone, including most of the city employees and all the neighbors, have put a lot of effort into trying to make this work in a most amenable way and at the least headache to the city and to all the neighbors. And I guess I don't know what the process is for reconsidering or, you know, because of the two votes that are already taken. But I would just like to encourage the City Council to figure out how to reconsider or maybe reevaluate it or whatever the process would be, as we are all pretty much in agreement that this would be a good thing for all the neighbors and the city. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Douglas, you here? Or you, there you are. I saw you.
Good evening, fellow councilors. I'm here to speak in opposition to the proposed resolution presented by the City of Northampton for the following reasons, which I will state.
And Douglas, I'm sorry, I'm going to interrupt you if you just state your full name.
Douglas Ross, 73 Barrett Street, by the Big White Plaza. We have many citizens in the community who have no place to go who are homeless every day, who are ignored, declared to be undesirable by the business community, and are forced to sleep in front doors of the very businesses you are urging assistance from and freezing temperatures. We have no adequate amount of available housing stock for our own citizens, none less the refugees you are proposing to take in. Lifelong residents are being forced to leave their very town that they were born and raised in because of a lack of affordable housing available to them in the community. Our police department and local institutions are not prepared to deal with the diversity that exists in our own community. Our governmental institutions lack diversity. Our police officers are inadequately trained to deal with the fundamental stresses these vulnerable communities have, and the city refuses to provide the adequate funding needed to properly train our officers in dealing with these sort of citizens. Our citizens refuse to take in the people they walk past every day in the city of Northampton or help them, even when they are offered money from them for a room. Do you expect them to help people from an international country who are considered to be non-white? Our federal government is providing less and less funding to states and local towns each and every day, and they're cutting social welfare programs. Can you in good conscience ignore your citizens who are vulnerable to the same conditions possible as refugees of Syria? No governmental fund should go to any refugee over the citizens who are struggling each and every day to find employment here, housing, and support in a community which prides itself on civic responsibility to its local citizens but seems to always come short. These are the issues that need to be considered and must be addressed, because to refuse to attempt to solve these problems that we're facing while trying to solve problems in the broader world is fundamentally irresponsible and wrong of this local council. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Francis Crow, please.
I'm Francis Crow from 3 Langworthy Road, Northampton. I'm here to speak for the resolution to bring Syrian refugees to Northampton. I have been in touch with Deirdre Griffin, who is the refugee coordinator from Syria in Springfield, and she tells me there are over 10 families in Springfield that they have settled. And I was involved with the sanctuary movement back in the early 80s in Northampton, and the people that we brought then all have been gainfully employed in Northampton and region. They are taxpayers. They have contributed to the community greatly. And Joaquin, one of the refugees in Amherst, daughter graduated from Amherst Regional High School 5 years ago with honor. She was the valedictorian of the class. She went to Tufts on a full scholarship and graduated this last year with honors. So they have contributed a lot to our communities. And I feel that the government seems to only know how to bomb people. And I think the very least we can do is to take the victims. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's all I have signed up. Is anyone else interested in speaking this time? Jeff, you had your hand up first.
My name is Jeff Napolitano. I live at 26 Wright Avenue, and I strongly urge you all to vote in favor of the resolution of support for refugees. I've actually been asked by the media in the past few days, why do I support refugees? And I find this question bewildering, as it seems so obvious both morally and pragmatically. I don't have enough time in these 3 minutes to go through all of the reasons, but here are a few. Because that obligation is a straightforward matter of binding international law, and because it was written by authors from the United States after World War II, by a generation that witnessed those fleeing from the horrors of war. If international law doesn't impress you, then you should support refugees simply because 50% of them fleeing places like Syria are children. If the argument regarding children in the abstract does not move you, then you should consider supporting refugees because had our country granted Otto Frank the refugee visa he so desperately requested, today his daughter Anne would be 86 years old. And you should support refugees out of a sense of responsibility, because our country's role in destabilizing Iraq and the Middle East has led to a huge number of terrible circumstances, including this entity known as ISIS, from which many refugees are fleeing. Because many of the bombs and bullets raining down in Syria have "Made in the USA" stamped on them, you should support refugees. Because in a political environment where presidential candidates are calling for mandatory registries of residents based upon faith, and the House of Representatives is currently proposing shutting down government until all refugees are kept out, political resolutions like this one are the very least things that we can do to push back as a city. Because Robert F. Kennedy said in another troubled time, when you teach a man to hate and to fear his brother, when you teach that those who differ from you threaten your freedom or your job or your family, then you also learn to confront others not as fellow citizens but as enemies, to be met not with cooperation but with conquest. Our lives on this planet are too short and the work to be done too great to let this spirit flourish in any longer in our land. Of course, we cannot vanish it with a program nor with a resolution. He continued, perhaps we can remember, even if only for a time, that those who live with us are our brothers, and they share with us the same short movement of life, and that they seek, as we do, nothing but the chance to live out their lives in purpose and happiness, winning what satisfaction and fulfillment they can. There are so many more reasons, but perhaps most of all, if I'm to live in a world where I have to actually argue between the choice of being one of those who welcome the thirsty, the hungry, and the unsheltered, or on the side of those who reject them, well, that's an easy choice to make. And tonight, it is the very, very least I and anyone in this room can do. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else wish to speak at this point?
I'm Carolyn Toll Oppenheim. I live at 3 Montview Avenue, Northampton. I'm a daughter of refugees. My parents themselves were not, but half my family were. And I came to awareness. I was 3 years old in 1945. In between 45 and 1950, my father was a social worker for a refugee resettlement agency. He was a fluent Yiddish speaker, and most of the refugees coming in at that time were coming from DP camps in Europe and were Jews and spoke Yiddish. My parents socialized with those refugees, and we had family members who were coming in. So the refugee thing has triggered a lot of trauma in a way for me, because my family was so absorbed in this, they weren't thinking about making a family and raising. We were just, you know, they were, you know, when it's like we were living in crisis mode for years. I can imagine what these people are going through, and I'm very proud that the Northampton City Council is considering the proposal. However, however doesn't mean I don't want the proposal. I want the proposal. It's not an ordinance. It's a resolution. It's aspirational, and we add to the chorus of voices that say no racism, because our governor heard some of those voices and backed off a little. So I'm proud, and I want our town to add to those voices. However, I'm also mindful that when we make these aspirational resolutions, we should think about the things Douglas raised as well. I was talking about refugees today with a woman who said, and you know, when they bring them over, they put them in slums. And I was sick to my stomach. Like, the refugees are more important than the people who live in substandard communities. That we feel good about ourselves when we say we want to bring in a refugee, and then we can feel good and dismiss the people who are here who live in the places that she thinks the refugees are too good to go to. It's that double thinking that I just want to. I think when we call for bring refugees, we have internal refugees in our community, and I just want us to be aware of that. And what this woman said about financial, in making the claim to our government, our federal government, to bring in refugees, we also have to talk about cutting back on some of the things they're spending so we can care for both the refugees and the internal refugees. I think that responsibility goes along with being that kind of a conscientious community. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? Okay. I'm going to ask the panel to call the roll, please.
Councilor Adams.
Here.
Councilor Carney.
Present.
Councilor Dwight.
Here.
Councilor Klein.
Here.
Councilor Labarge.
Present.
Councilor Murphy.
Here.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Here.
Councilor Shara.
Here.
Councilor Spector.
Here.
We have a quorum. In fact, everybody's here. So this is the penultimate meeting of the City Council this session, actually. We have one more meeting this year, and then the new council gets sworn in the first meeting in January. So the business that we're dealing with today is cumulative from the year and also the business that has recently transpired. First up, are there any communications from the mayor? Nope, the mayor passes. We have now a presentation from Marianne Winters, who's the executive director of Safe Passage. And this is relevant, of course, to the 12th annual hot chocolate run for Safe Passage. And the event is scheduled December 6th, which is days away. And Miriam, you have the floor.
So you're controlling it with left?
Okay, great.
Yeah, Marianne, this is all our brand new G-Wiz equipment. You're the first person to break it in.
Okay, well, I just got my technical orientation, so thank you for that, Pamela.
Thank you for inaugurating it for us.
Yes, okay. Well, thank you so much. My name is Marianne Winters. I'm the executive director of Safe Passage. We are proud to serve Northampton as well as all of Hampshire County and many people and Western Mass in general for some of our programs. Many of you know us as a shelter that houses people who have many characteristics similar to refugees, those who are fleeing domestic violence. We have been in existence since 1977. We started under the name Necessities Necessidades. And this community is, hardly a week goes by where I don't meet a former board member or a volunteer or staff member. We have a long-standing relationship and presence within this community. Okay. Went too many clicks. Okay, the slide that I just passed by is our new mission and vision. We recently changed our mission to in order to broaden our scope. And oh, thank you. And some of the pivots that we think we'll be accomplishing and experiencing through this mission, first of all, is a shift from an acknowledgement that domestic violence is primarily an issue that affects women, and indeed it is. It also affects people of all genders. So we are intentionally letting the world know and programming and developing policy to be gender inclusive for women, men, as well as transgender folks. We are also shifting somewhat from a primary focus on individual impact, so working in counseling, advocacy, and shelter, all of those things we will continue to do, to more resources being put toward community engagement in prevention, policy, that sort of thing. And then the final shift that you'll notice in our language and our website and in our mission is a move from being against something, that being against domestic violence, to really trying to articulate and provide leadership on what the world would look like without domestic violence. And that's a shift in going from being against to being for something is a very important part of our identity and our work right now. We organize our work around the theory of the social ecological model, and this is a model that I'll describe briefly, which can be applied to many important issues, and it helps us understand the work that we do from the individual level, the things that we do to change lives individually, to help people, to advocate, all the way up through societal issues, and so relationships, systems and institutions, and policy. And so that theory is applied to many social service kinds of issues, social change, and we have some specific things that I want to highlight that we do under each of those categories. Around the individual activity, some of the highlights, we provide actual financial assistance to survivors who may be an electric bill or a first month's rent or a car repair away from maintaining a job or being homeless. homelessness and domestic violence are intertwined. If you're not safe at home, and you know the only choice that you might have is to leave that situation, you are at grave risk of becoming homeless. So we also do, one of the first things that we do with people when they call or come to our office is safety planning. This is an individual approach to understanding the circumstances and helping figure out what might make a circumstance more safe for someone. This mostly happens and is a service that we mostly do for people who are living in the community in a domestic violence situation. Most people think about domestic violence, the solution meaning leaving and going to shelter, and in fact that happens. We work with about 70 families a year. We work with many more families who are currently living at some level of risk of domestic violence in their homes right now, and it's for them that we work at safety planning responses. That might include giving them a free cell phone that we do through Verizon Hopeline phones, or a whole variety of issues. On the second level, could you go back, please, Pamela? On the relationship level, we have recently launched a program called Say Something. This is a prevention program that's focused on training bystanders, which are all of us, on how and when and developing the skills to respond in a situation that could potentially be threatening. The Say Something program basically is from the premise that everybody, no matter who you are, what you do in your life, whether you're a parent, a teacher, a city councilor, or the mayor, has something that you can say to someone that might bring us closer to that vision of a world without violence. Around systems, we work in close collaboration with many of the people that that work in law enforcement, district attorneys. We are a central part of the high-risk assessment team with the Northwestern District Attorney's Office. This is a team of interdisciplinary professionals that receives referrals from law enforcement, from social service providers, from neighbors in the community of situations that are showing a high risk of homicide. We have research, and this is based on national research, that tells us the types of circumstances to look for that might help us predict when a potential homicide could potentially happen, and therefore, if we can predict it, we can also work to prevent it. So that's a team that's working behind the scenes every day on particular cases happening right now in Northampton. We also have a domestic violence intervention project, which are advocates that respond 24 hours a day in the aftermath of a police call. So we have an advocate making contact with a victim right after a police call to help them understand what services there are, what resources there might be. And we're also part of a domestic violence roundtable, again with the district attorney's office and others, to work on system reform. In terms of the community level, we develop relationships, sometimes subcontracts that are funded with other organizations. Our most recent is a collaboration with Hilltown Community Health Centers. And even though these are folks that don't live in Northampton, they often need to have better access to the services, courts, police, other things that are in Northampton. And so we fund a rural domestic violence advocate that works in the hill towns outside of Northampton. We also work our hotline in a collaborative with two other organizations, the Center for Women and Community at UMass and NELQUIT, which is in Franklin County. Around the issues of policy change and social change, we work on legislation issues. A recent gain that we celebrate in Massachusetts is a bill that was passed in 2014 that added protections, that added increased penalties and for perpetrators who commit strangulation or suffocation as part of a domestic violence altercation or part of a domestic violence incident. It also added workplace protections, unemployment issues, that sort of thing. We also every year work on budget advocacy both at the state and federal level. We also do extensive work around communications and messaging that are aimed at raising awareness around domestic violence, and also it always include a call to action so that people can understand how they can have an impact on prevention. So we have been doing a lot of planning. The goodwill of this community has allowed us to have a certain level of unrestricted funding, and we steward that very carefully. We are eternally grateful to the community's help with that. Last year, the Hot Chocolate Run raised nearly $400,000. With that, we hired a full-time advocate for children and families in shelter. We have also developed our prevention program with that, with those funds. This year, it's looking like we are likely to exceed that amount. So that money we have used to actually plan and to be engaged in some of the emerging work that's happening around domestic violence. Some of those things are developing more culturally specific approaches. We have we've trained our staff in working with members of the GLBT community to look at same-sex domestic violence and understand how we can screen and understand the dynamics, how they may be similar to opposite-sex domestic violence, but also how we can decide and how we can kind of determine who the primary victim is, who the primary perpetrator, how best to intervene in that relationship. We're working on with health systems. The Affordable Care Act actually includes provisions that incentivize healthcare systems to do screening training. And I'm always curious to hear if more and more people are being asked that question when they go to the doctor or to the emergency room, if they're safe at home. And that is because there's a national effort underway to train healthcare providers, not only in the emergency room, but in every aspect of healthcare to screen for domestic violence. The health impact of trauma puts victims of trauma at a higher risk for just about all of the health issues that we're all concerned about, higher risk of breast cancer, cervical cancer, gastrointestinal problems, heart disease, diabetes, all of those things. And so survivors are receiving health care from all of those conditions, and those are really important places for people to be working on these issues. We also understand more and more the economic impact of domestic violence, that if someone's being victimized at home, they very often drop out of school, it's difficult for them to work, an abusive partner may sabotage their efforts to work, may sabotage their, you know, their ability to put food on the table, to allocate resources. So we're working on, you know, some the next big step for us is working toward hiring potentially an economic advocate who will work specifically with survivors on rebuilding or sometimes building for the first time a sense of goals and dreams and an economic future for themselves and their children. Integrative therapies are now scientifically being shown to actually be of tremendous help to survivors of trauma. Therapies such as yoga, massage, body work, mindfulness are practices that are being integrated within domestic violence programs. That's another area that we're exploring. Another area that has some recent research has emerged is around reproductive justice. And there's a concept that has emerged that's called reproductive coercion, whereby in some cases, domestic violence may include efforts to sabotage someone's birth control, sabotage their decisions around their reproductive choices, either force an abortion or force a pregnancy, all of those things under that category of reproductive coercion. And there's a practice that we're in the process of training our staff on called reproductive first aid, where we help people assess if they need access to Plan B, if they are utilizing birth control, you know, what type of birth control can they utilize where potentially it can't be sabotaged by an abusive partner. Our community engaged prevention work is growing, and our workforce enhancement is growing. We have taken a really strong stance on creating a positive work environment. We've adjusted our salaries so that that our workplace is a desirable place to work. Our board has set a goal that says that if you want to work around domestic violence in Western Mass or indeed in Massachusetts, you have to come by Safe Passage and work here for a while. And so we want to create a condition where that is favorable. And so we have a very low turnover because of that. But we've constantly worked on that. So those are some of our aspirations. Another aspiration, we know that with more community engagement, we are going to need more space and we're going to need more of a public public space. So we've put together a space committee to look at what possibilities there are to create kind of a community center to work on violence issues. And that's something that we really hope to put together and to present to the community within the next couple of years. So our relationship with the City of Northampton is crucial for our work together. We have lots of ideas for the ways that we can work it together at a more deeper level. One way is through thinking about our schools in terms of becoming trauma-informed settings. This is also a national model that's in practice in many cities, where teachers, administrators, counselors, in fact, the whole school community understands children's behavior around learning, understands their developmental behaviors in the context of what trauma they may be enduring or going through. So it moves beyond the idea of reporting trauma when it's disclosed to really sort of building communities that understand that learning is difficult when kids are going through trauma, in particular domestic violence. So we would love to do some training. We would love to see the City Council model these bystander skills. We would offer, you know, you the opportunity to go through one of our labs, which are 4-session trainings on how to be we call them prevention superheroes. You know, we could give you a cape if you like. Promoting the economic connections. You know, as we develop our economic advocacy work, promoting relationships with businesses and institutions and training programs is going to be crucial. And then also supporting our health collaborations. There are also many opportunities for you to think about yourself as Northampton as an employer. The Domestic Violence Reform Act of 2014 included issues like domestic violence leave as being available to domestic violence survivors. Whereas before, if you left a job because you were fleeing violence, you would not be eligible for unemployment. This is something that now many survivors are eligible for. Thinking about protocols and policies for employees of city government who might be survivors, and also for employees who also might be abusers. Because I can guarantee that in the various settings where people work for the city, there are people on both ends of that. Safety issues at the workplace, so that if someone is being abused and they're an employee of the city, they don't feel like they have to leave their work, that you can form policies that actually support them, maintain their privacy and their dignity, and create a safe workspace. Rights of workers around some of these potential things, thinking about children in schools and their relationship with public safety. So all those things, I think, I would love to sit down with whoever's willing, create a strategic plan where we could work on some of these things, because I think, we're large enough where we can get some of these things done, yet small enough where we can know one another and try things out and make these things happen. So for all of these reasons, the Hot Chocolate Run is really kind of the platform that gives us some of the flexibility that we would not otherwise have if we were, almost entirely dependent on government funds. So I would encourage us all to take advantage of this opportunity. And again, I really appreciate your time at this meeting and your proposal that's on the table.
Thank you. Any questions or comments from the council? Thanks so much for your time.
Okay. Thank you.
And thank you for the work. Which allows us to actually seamlessly transition into the first resolution that's before us, which is the resolution to raise awareness that domestic violence is a human rights concern. And I will read it, and then I'll accept the motion and put it on the floor after it's done. And this upon the recommendation of the city. Oh, whoop, wait a minute, wrong one. The right one. This is upon the recommendation of Councilors Elisa F. Klein and Gina Louise Shara as the resolution on domestic violence. And whereas the United Nations, world leaders, and leaders within the United States have all recognized that domestic violence is a human rights issue, and whereas the City of Northampton seeks to enhance the public welfare of its residents by declaring the freedom from, whoops, hang on a second. Okay. Whereas the City of Northampton seeks to enhance the public welfare of its residents by declaring that freedom from domestic violence is a fundamental human right. And whereas it is estimated that each year up to 9 million individuals in the United States are victims of intimate partner violence. That is, according to the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, more than 1 in 3 women and more than 1 in 4 men in the United States will experience rape, physical violence, and or stalking by an intimate partner at some point in their lives. And whereas domestic violence affects adults and children of all backgrounds and ages, but women experience more domestic violence than men and are significantly more likely than men to be injured during an assault by an intimate partner. And whereas only approximately 1/4 of all physical assaults, 1/5 of all rapes, and 1/2 of all stalking incidents perpetrated against women by intimate partners are reported to the police. And whereas 15.5 million children in the United States live in families in which domestic violence was perpetrated at least once in the past year and are adversely affected by violence in the home, and whether they are physically or verbally abused themselves or exposed to the violence as witnesses. And whereas victims and survivors of domestic and family violence experience physical injuries, long-term psychological damage, financial instability, difficulty finding safe housing, and other challenges, some of which directly or indirectly relate to services provided by the city. And whereas domestic violence is cited as a significant factor in homelessness among families. And whereas the economic burden of domestic violence in the United States is over $8 billion per year in direct medical costs and the loss of productivity. And whereas Safe Passage, formerly called Necessidades, in Northampton, has worked to prevent, respond to, and end domestic violence and serve survivors of domestic violence and their children, friends, and families in Hampshire County since 1977. And in 2014 alone, served over 1,400 individuals from Hampshire County. And whereas Safe Passage operates a crisis hotline serving victims and survivors of domestic violence 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, to offer crisis intervention, support, information, and referrals, as well as provides ongoing trauma-informed counseling and advocacy in a safe residence for survivors of domestic violence and their families. And whereas the Northampton Police Department, Hampshire County Sheriff's Office, Northwest District Attorney's Office, Northampton Health Department, and other city government offices, as well as social service agencies and nonprofit groups, have worked with Safe Passage to implement a coordinated system for the prevention of and the response to acts of violence and family violence in the city. And whereas those aforementioned entities and other local government entities incur significant monetary costs due to the domestic and family violence, and whereas Safe Passage estimates that more than 15,000 women in Hampshire County have experienced intimate partner violence in their lifetime, and whereas community members were informed and skilled in recognizing domestic violence and supporting survivors, along with local medical personnel, the police and sheriff's departments, courts, social service agencies, and other government entities, constitute the first line of defense against domestic violence. And whereas in 2012, the Northampton Police Department responded to 509 domestic calls. And whereas the Northampton City Council wishes to raise awareness and educate the residents of Northampton about the grave implications and the consequences of domestic violence on individuals and families because of public awareness, has the potential to increase the identification and the reporting of abuse by the public, professionals, and victims themselves, and can act as a catalyst for prevention. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the City Council of Northampton, Massachusetts, 1, joins the United Nations and leaders throughout the world and within the United States in recognition of domestic violence as a human rights concern, and declares that the freedom from domestic and family violence is a fundamental human right, and 2, commits to raising awareness of domestic violence and its devastating effects on survivors, families, and communities, and cooperating with all city departments, non-governmental organizations, and local businesses to promote programs that prevent and respond to domestic violence. And 3, pledges its continued support for Safe Passage and all other entities designed to prevent and respond to domestic violence, including assisting victims and survivors, holding perpetrators accountable, and bringing an end to domestic violence. And 4, declares that the city is committed to responding diligently to acts of domestic and family violence, that all the city's departments shall incorporate the principles embodied in this resolution into their policies and practices, and encourages all local organizations and agencies to do so as well. And finally, 5, we'll send a copy of this resolution to the Northwest District Attorney's Office, the Northampton Health Department, Hampshire Sheriff's Office, the Northampton Police Department, and other city departments and local agencies. Accept the motion and put it on the floor.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion.
I just want to say I'm very proud to be a co-sponsor on this resolution. And I want to thank Councilor Klein and Marion and Laura from Safe Passage for the incredibly hard work that they put into it. Safe Passage is very dear to my heart, and I thank you for the amazing work that you do every day, as is the Hot Chocolate Run, which is considered one of the important winter holidays in my house. And I've watched in wonder and gratitude as it's gone from this event that was dreamed up by Jennifer Garinger and John Fry in 2004, and they raised $6,000 and were blown away to have raised that amount, to the event it is now, with just the love and dedication from so many volunteers and the amazing staff at Safe Passage, in particular Sarah Smith, who in my house at this time of the year, actually all times of the year, is known as Big Hot Chocolate. And it's turned into this event where, as you heard Marianne say, raised almost $400,000 last year. It's now nationally recognized as an event. It's truly a remarkable thing. It really does feel like kind of ushers in this holiday season. It's a fun, joyous event, and my family looks forward to it every year. But in addition to anticipating the hot chocolate and the marshmallows, every year in my house we also talk about and build on educating my girls, who since they've been born have participated. I've been educating them on why we come together and do this with each other every year. And they know a little bit more year by year that it's to help families and children to have a safe home like they have. So I thank you so very much for the work that you do.
Councilor Klein, you're one of the sponsors. So you want to speak to this at all?
No, I think that the resolution itself says what needs to be said. I think that Councilor Shara put the heart behind the words of the resolution, and I'm really proud to co-sponsor this and encourage everyone to support it.
Any other discussion? I'd like to thank the sponsors. I'm also very grateful for the presence of Safe Passage, for the services that they provide, and as I said before, that domestic violence and abuse tends to be the secret violence, the violence that doesn't necessarily make the headlines until it's so horrible that it results in arrest or response. But the ones that don't actually have as much of an adverse and profound effect on the community at large, and to the extent that you can't even really be cognizant of it, but the intangible impacts are huge and significant. And the fact that I am grateful for Safe Passage and this community devoting itself to outing it as an aberration in the community that's not the reflection of our best interests. So I'm grateful for the resolution, grateful for the good work. I too have also participated in the Hot Chocolate Run from the very first one. Didn't walk or run. I stood in the freezing cold and emceed it. That was down in front of People's Institute during a wind tunnel. And at that point, and the fact is that the reason it's so successful is it's very well organized, but it's clearly you have people coming from all over, not for the pleasure of running through the streets of Northampton on a cold day and a hot mug of chocolate at the end of it. I mean, it's clearly, it resonates with so many people, and it has such value that it's actually a joy to participate in. So thank you again. And anybody else who's interested in speaking? If not, we can move right to the vote. This is a resolution, doesn't require a roll call vote, but is there a preference for a roll call? Well, I'm going to do it anyway. Okay, roll call, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Spector?
Yes.
Counselor Adams?
Yes.
Passes unanimously in first reading. It'll be taken up again in our last meeting of the year for a second reading. Thank you again. Next up is a resolution. Once again, we have Counselor Klein's hand in this. This is the upon the recommendation of City Council President William H. Dwight, Counselors Elisa F. Klein and Maureen T. Carney, and the Mayor's Youth Commission. And this is a resolution calling for the welcoming of refugees in the city of Northampton. And whereas the city of Northampton is largely comprised of residents and the descendants of families who came to the United States from countries all over the world, and whereas the city of Northampton has been built in large part on the strength of its immigrant communities, and whereas the city of Northampton embraces ethnic, racial, and linguistic diversity, and whereas the city of where the people of Northampton have a long history of opening their arms and homes to the vulnerable and disadvantaged, and a commitment to fostering an open and welcoming democracy in which humanitarian efforts are embraced, and whereas the city of Northampton, as in previous resolutions, such as the 2011 resolution of the Northampton City Council on the Secure Communities Program and the preservation of our civil rights, affirmed its belief that a diverse population contributes to the vitality of our community and asserted its commitment to the protection of human and civil rights of all who reside in and visit the city. And whereas the conflict in Syria has caused a refugee crisis, which the city of Northampton will not ignore, and whereas more than 7 million Syrians have been displaced by the war, and the number of refugees fleeing the conflict in Syria constitutes the world's single largest refugee crisis in almost a quarter of a century, and whereas many of those referred to the United States for resettlement are the most vulnerable of the Syrian refugees, such as survivors of torture, people with special medical needs, women who head households, and children. And whereas President Obama is committed to accepting 10,000 Syrian refugees within the next year, and whereas those wishing to come to the United States must apply through the United Nations and are subject to the highest level of security checks of any category of traveler to our country by the National Counterterrorism Center and the FBI's Terrorist Screening Center and the Departments of State, Defense, and Homeland Security. And whereas since 9/11, more than 750,000 refugees have been resettled in the United States, and not one has been convicted of plotting a terrorist act in the United States. And whereas despite the fact that they have no legal standing to dictate refugee and immigration policy to the federal government or determine who will live in their states, more than half the governors of the 50 U.S. states, including the governor of the Commonwealth, Charles Baker, have declared their opposition to Syrian refugee resettlement in their cities. And whereas the Supreme Court of the United States explained in Hines versus Davidetz, the supremacy of the national power in the general field of foreign affairs, including power over immigration, naturalization, and deportation, is made clear by the Constitution, close quote. And whereas the Refugee Act of 1980 declared, quote, the historic policy of the United States to respond to the urgent needs of persons subject to persecution in their homelands, close quote, and gave the President the power to handle, end quote, unforeseen emergency refugee situation, close quote, such as one involving, quote, grave humanitarian concerns. And whereas Article 14.1 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, adopted by the United States of America in 1948, states everyone has the right to seek and to enjoy in other countries asylum from persecution. And whereas the United States of America ratified both in 1951 Convention relating to the status of refugees, the 1967 Protocol, we have a binding obligation under binding international law to protect refugees and to receive victims of political persecution. And whereas the Convention of the Rights of the Child, to which the United States of America's party applies to all children without discrimination, including child refugees and asylum seekers, the convention specifically stipulates that every child seeking refugee status has the right to protection and humanitarian assistance in the enjoyment of the rights set forth in that convention and in others to which the state is a party. And whereas Syrian refugees should be treated with the dignity, care, compassion that every person deserves, and require housing and support services such as counseling, education, health care, food, security, case management, and legal assistance. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Northampton City Council of Massachusetts affirms that Northampton is committed to serving as a place of sanctuary and refuge for the refugees from around the world, and urges city departments, local businesses, and charitable organizations to provide shelter, sustenance, and other services for refugee families relocating to and integrating into our community. And whereas urges residents to consider demonstrating their support and willingness and availability of space to take in refugees by signing the petition at afscwm.org/blog/2015/11/24/we-welcome-refugees. You can go to AFSC's website. You can find the link there. And in other ways they deem useful. And lastly, requests of the governor to reconsider his stated opposition to Syrian refugee resettlement in Massachusetts and thereby affirm the values of our community and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. I'll accept a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? Councilor
Spector. Well, I'll start since you, in the resolution, as mentioned, the 1951 convention that we signed on to. One reason, if you look at history, that that convention took place and that we signed that resolution was in part what was witnessed that happened to especially a couple of very specific cases of Jewish children trying to come into the United States. In 1938, 1939, it was interesting that Congress, I had some of the quotes which I was trying to find, but I can't find them. Quotes from some of the Congress people in 1938 or 1939, if I read them to you, they would sound exactly like what many of the Congress people said today, almost word for word. Things like, and I really wish I could have found, things like, these people are, we've got to take care of our own people first. That these people don't share our values or our culture. These people come from another background and we can't integrate them. We already have too many people who are not enough like us. Every one of the quotes, and I really wish you can try and Google it and find it yourself, but I lost the Wi-Fi here. Every one of those quotes was said in the last few weeks in the House of Representatives. And this was said about 20,000 Jewish children who were on boats coming to this country. And the reason that convention took place, and God forbid it happens again, is because after the fact, after the war, when people weren't as panicked, and it's the panic that takes place, it's the fear that takes place. You know, Patrick Henry said, give me liberty or give me death. He didn't say give me security or give me death. That liberty takes some degree of courage. And courage is about having some strength, even though you're frightened, to go ahead and support the values you have. That's what courage is about. It's not that you're afraid, that you're not afraid. You are afraid. We all have a little bit of that fear. But courage, which I hope this country can have, is about saying we're going to do the right thing by our values in a time when we do have some fear. Because those 20,000 Jewish children went back, and most reports say that 4/5 of them ended up in concentration camps and died. And that's why you had 6 years after the close of the war when people felt more secure to sit back and say, oh my God, what an awful thing we did. What an awful thing we did with the Japanese internment camps. What an awful thing we did by not allowing those children in and hundreds of thousands of others. And not only that, the U.S. Virgin Islands, back in 1939 and 1940, the U.S. territories, the Virgin Islands, said, we will accept 150,000 Jews. The U.S. Congress said, we're not going to let you do that, and they blockaded that. 150,000 Jews were sent back to Europe. And you had case after case of this. The Dominican Republic offered to take in something over 100,000 Jews. The United States Congress said, we're not going to let you do that, and they blockaded it. 100,000 Jews went back to Europe. At that time, Jews were kind of different to a lot of Americans. I don't know if Americans at that time, if they were the English coming over, we would have had the same feeling. I think now as Jews have been integrated into this culture, Syrians, I'm not so sure. They're still the other. And that's one of the other things you hear in those congressional statements. Now, some folks call and they say, what are we doing talking about these bigger issues like this Northampton gets into? On this particular one, I think it's very clear that our governor had no authority to talk on this issue. He has no more authority than we do. And I said to a few of those people, So when Governor Baker came out and make this statement, I'm sure you, who thinks we shouldn't bring this up, you called Governor Baker because he has as little authority as we do. So I'm sure you called him up because you were very concerned about, you know, distribution of power. Of course, they didn't call Governor Baker up. So this whole question of whether we should bring this forth, it's going to have to be from the grassroots. And finally, let me just say we're at a very frightening time to me. I've never seen anything like it. I think we have to name it. And one of the things we have to name is that we have some candidates running for president who are fascists. And let's, thankfully, some of our newspapers, which very few people read anymore, but the New York Times, the Washington Post, finally in the last few weeks, have decided to call something for what it is, and they are using that word. And a lot of this is very political. This is a very political thing to do. And I want to stand with the side of politics, which says we are not going to have this kind of language tolerated. We're going to stand up against it. We're going to receive people. And I'm proud that this is coming forward as a resolution.
Thank you. Councilor Klein.
Thank you, Councilor Spector. I really appreciate those remarks. I want to build on some of the things that you said. I think that when we talk about immigrants and refugees, we really have to pay close attention to history, because we have seen prejudice and stereotypes against refugees throughout history. My family were refugees from Eastern Europe, first from pogroms around the turn of the 20th century, then the Second World War and the Holocaust. And the other side of my family were refugees from the 1956 Hungarian Revolution. And I imagine that a lot of the residents of Northampton are also descendants of refugees. And like today's current Syrian refugees, they've experienced prejudice, stereotypes, quotas when trying to enter the United States, and even bans on the entrance into the country. And thinking about the makeup of the citizens of Northampton, you know, we look at people, we have a lot of people of Polish descent. There are 10 million Americans of Polish descent in the United States today. And they came as economic refugees and refugees from forces that occupied Poland until 1919. And they were refugees from religious persecution by those occupying forces. And there was deep discrimination against Polish refugees and Polish immigrants when they came to the United States. In fact, there were quotas that were developed, anti-Polish legislation that cut Polish immigration into the U.S. between 1921 until after World War II. So, you know, we can look at these historical examples of how the people that make up today's population in Northampton, their descendants were persecuted as well, and were persecuted here in the United States, I should say. Also looking at people of Irish ancestry, there are 33 million Americans of Irish ancestry here. A lot of them were, again, economic refugees because of the Great Irish Famine in the 1840s. They were targeted here in the U.S. with really virulent anti-Catholic sentiment and laws, and a large portion of their immigration was stopped when Congress passed Emergency Immigration Acts of 1921 and 1924. Those acts imposed a quota system that limited Irish immigration, and people were, again, virulently against them for their Catholicism, their difference, all of that. You know, I want to also address some of the concerns that I have heard from folks about how somehow if we talk about accepting refugees and opening our homes, opening our hearts to refugees, we're somehow neglecting the people that were born here, that already live here. I don't think it's an either-or situation, and I appreciate some of the public comment that pointed out that it's not an either-or situation. I do understand that concern because we have a lot of people in Northampton that are struggling to make ends meet. And the last thing that we would want to do is create a situation whereby we're making it harder for them because we're using money that could be used for those folks to assist them. But when you do research, there's so much research out there about cities all over the world and in the United States that have taken in large refugee populations, and consistently the economies of those places were not affected negatively. This is absolutely objective research, and I'm not going to sit here and bore you with all of the details, but if anybody's interested, I'm happy to send you links to a number of different studies that show this. Even currently in places that have taken in large numbers of Syrian refugees, in Lebanon, in Jordan, in Turkey, the economies in all of those places are actually booming right now. And that's concurrent with them absorbing hundreds of thousands of refugees. One case that I would like to point out is Cleveland, Ohio, which is where I was born, so I have a certain affinity to the city. Their local refugee services agency spent $4.8 million in 2012 in helping refugees get established in Cleveland. And during that same time, they had roughly 10 times, but the economic impact those refugees had on the community weighed in at about $48 million. In other words, the economy improved by 10 times, even with the resettlement costs that were paid for the refugees. So we have real life concrete examples of how taking in refugees does not in fact take away from the local economy, does not take jobs away from local workers. So just to kind of lay some of that concern to rest, I would really encourage people that are worried about that to look at the research that's been done all over the world and in the United States. I'm really thrilled about the support that I've got. We've heard from people that I've gotten phone calls and emails from people supporting this and really excited about it. And I really encourage my fellow counselors to support this. Thanks. Thanks for letting me go on a little bit.
Thank you. I want to thank my fellow counselors, Klein and Dwight, for bringing forward this resolution and allowing me to join as a co-sponsor. And I don't have a lot to add to the really thoughtful comments right now of Councilor Spector and Councilor Klein, except to say that personally, I mean, that I am a grandchild of economic refugees from Ireland. And I just see it as such an American thing to do, to open our arms and to continue. It's a tradition. It feels very traditionally American to be open to immigrants, especially those seeking asylum from a war-torn nation. So I'm really proud to be able to co-sponsor this resolution and thank my fellow councilors for bringing it forward.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes, I will support this resolution. I did receive some calls of people having great concerns of this resolution and what our job is actually to do here as city councilors. That some of them felt that we were going above what we should be doing and just taking care of our own city. And I'm just explaining to you to let you know what I'm hearing. I had to disagree with that. I looked at it differently. They had concerns about where is this money going to come from in the city. The budget was a biggie. That we're always hearing concerns about the schools and the funding of the schools. And I don't look at it that way. Councilor Klein, you talk about where you lived, your ancestors lived. My father came from Greece with five in his family on a boat and arrived in New York City. My dad received his citizenships. You look on in TV and you see what's happening. It's disgusting. Why shouldn't we open our arms? And I agree with you, Councilor Carney. I think that's very valuable. We're looking at our elderly. We're looking at women, children. And the destruction that's occurring out there is terrible. In my family's country in Greece, they opened up their arms. and they help those children and elderly people off the boats, gave them water, fed them. To me, that's in your heart, because you're just going to help whatever is needed. And I think it is our job as counselors to go ahead and accept whoever into our city who needs the help. And I will support this resolution.
Councilor Murphy.
You know, at the end of this term, I will have been here for 10 years. I have never had more people call me since Tuesday when this appeared in the paper. I've had more people call me about this than anything else in a 10-year period of time. It's very unbelievable. And to a one, they said, what the expletive is the city council doing dealing with something over which it has no authority? I mean, we do not have the authority to deny anyone the right to live in the city of Northampton. You can move here. You can set up your household. We have nothing to say about that. You live here. We provide you services. And that's what most of the people said to me. Why is the city council dealing with something over which they have no authority? And this resolution in it admonishes the governors of 25 states who have no legal authority to dictate the standing of refugees or immigration policy. Well, why is the converse not true? We have the right to take a position on immigration policy, but the governors of 25 states don't. None of us do. And this is quite clear about the fact that that authority lies with the federal government. You know, it's not up to us. It's not up to the states. It's up to the federal government. You know, this community has always welcomed anyone who wanted to move here. Well, not anyone who ever wanted to move here, because I'm of Irish heritage. And at the state hospital, there's a monument to two young Irishmen this community hung because they were young Irishmen. So right here at home, you know, we have been guilty of discrimination, but what my constituents were concerned about was the fact that we don't have authority on this. The state governor doesn't have authority on this. Our federal government does. And they wanted me to bring that message here, that they felt that this was a little above and beyond our purview. Now, I very much support the sponsors of this and the fact that they brought this before the body, but as I have done before with things that I think are a little outside of our purview, I'm going to abstain from voting on this one. And again, that's because of the overwhelming feel. I mean, you cannot believe how many calls I got from people today saying, you know, why are you dealing with this at this level? So I felt I had to bring that here tonight.
Could you just scroll down the resolution to the beginning? Because I don't have a copy, I can't pull it up.
Yeah, I'm just trying to find the language, because I'm sorry. That, Councilor Murphy, I will say one thing. You have been consistent. I've been here with you for 10 years, so I want to come to Councilor Murphy's defense. He has always abstained from votes on these larger issues. So he's been very consistent on that. Whatever the issue is, even when at times you said, I'm really behind that, but I don't believe we should be doing that. That being said, even in the name of this resolution, it's a resolution calling for the welcoming of refugees. And I don't think we would be talking about, that's why I said this is political. And that's why it's important. And that's why it's unique. And that's why it's being done today, is because we have voices out there, whether it's the governor's voice who has no authority, but someone has to counter those voices. And if it's going to have to be on a local level, if it's even going to have to be on a personal level with letters to the editor or talking to your neighbor, but someone's got to raise their voice. Or it won't just be like the 6 years after World War II, where everybody felt so guilty they signed on to a refugee convention because we felt so awful. No, it'll be more like what people said after Nazi Germany said, why don't we say anything? This is a statement, Mr. Murphy. You're totally clear that this is not, we have no authority here. However, the things that are being said need to be countered. And because it is saying, we are just saying we are welcoming the refugees. To me, I would hope that on this one issue, you would understand in that statement and you would, because I think this may be a unanimous vote and I would like it to be, I would strongly encourage you to support that. because this does not claim that we are taking over any authority. We're saying we are welcoming. That's a statement of kind of our feeling about it. It's a statement being made to larger forces out there, and I would hope we could pass this unanimously in this council.
The reason the resolutions are actually embedded in our august authority, resolutions are actually, as everyone notes, has no, doesn't carry the weight of law. It's an expression of will, and it's an expression of community will. And what's very important, given the rhetoric and also the litany of shame that Councilor Spector has given us, the retrospective shame, I don't want to revisit that. Silence is complicity. If we don't say anything, as a community or as individuals, or anything else, we are complicit. And I have received also a lot of calls and a lot of letters and in the form of email and a lot of personal contacts and discussion with people who have said over and over again, not in our name. We are not, right now, what's being said in our name is being said by Governor Baker. Mm-hmm. The debates that are taking place on presidential platforms and elsewhere are terrifying. They're absolutely terrifying and antithetical to everything that we supposedly claim we are. If we don't speak to this point, and we just speak to potholes, and we're limited to that, then we should eliminate resolutions entirely as part of our purview. I think that most of these broader resolutions, and I'm not going to argue the issue about resolutions, you know, I've also spoke with people who felt this is way out of our ken. You know, you take care of our own, just take care of our own, and then we'll, you know, you've got no business talking about anything else, nor the professional skill set, and maybe they're right. The fact is that we actually supposedly speak to some degree because we are a representative body. We are speaking for the community at large. We can't do polls. We're not doing an election. But we are, when we put ourselves out to be elected, we say, this is who we are. This is where our moral core is. If you agree with me, then vote for me if you think that I'd be a qualified representative voice for you. And as such, that comes the responsibility to speak loudly and to speak emphatically when we find something that is so egregious. And in this instance, the response to Syrian refugees, 10,000 Syrian refugees, if dispersed throughout the United States, would disappear. There are millions in Europe. We're taking 10,000 that will be vetted, and they could qualify for secret government office once they get through here. The bulk of the crimes that have been perpetrated on us violently in this country, the bulk, I mean, that's not even an apt description, have all been perpetrated by Americans born and raised here in this country and predominantly white, and all men, with very few exceptions. We cannot sit silently by while, for political gain possibly, this issue is exploited to our shame. I am ashamed now. I don't want to even be more ashamed in retrospect. Silence is complicity. We are not being silent. Councilor Murphy.
And I don't want to call into question the usefulness of resolutions to us. I mean, I was just very happy to vote for one on domestic violence. You know, we have a police department in Northampton that enforces laws on domestic violence and I think cooperates with the agency at hand to the greatest extent they can. So there's one that is within our authority. We do enforce with our police department laws about domestic violence, and we play a role in that, and I'm glad that we do. So I wouldn't call all of the whole process of resolutions in doubt, because I just was happy to vote for one. You know, they're useful to us as a means of communication.
Councilor Dow.
When you brought up, when you made the comment that a lot of people may question whether we have the skill set to weigh in on this is an easy joke to make, but I'm you know, pretty sure a supermajority in Congress also lacks that skill set to make informed decisions about foreign policy in a humane and wise way. And again, it sounds like an easy crack to make, but I actually believe it. And I also, well, here's why I believe it. I think that we do live in a tough world that's not made out of cotton candy and unicorns. And I can prove it, too. But that's to say that if there's a concern about screening procedures, this kind of thing, that's a rational thing to discuss. I honestly don't think that our leaders at the national level, even people running for office, are primarily thinking of that. I think they're reacting to polls. And I think they're reacting, as Councillor Spector pointed out very eloquently, I might add, they're reacting to fear. And that's not, that's a reaction as opposed to leadership. And I guess what I think is that polls change. And again, as Councillor Spector points out, you know, the polls of today become the history of tomorrow. And one day we'll look back and be our own judge about how we acted today. So a big difference here, I think, is not just local versus national. Formal power versus just weighing in. I think the question is showing some moral leadership versus just reacting and caving into fear. I think anyone who is standing up and closing the door on Syrian refugees has to reckon with that fact, that that's what you're doing. You're surrendering to fear. And you're not just closing the door on Syrian refugees, you're closing the door and aren't part of who we are. That's kind of what Councillor Carney was saying. You know, there's very few things, I think, that really remind us that we have common principles as a nation. Call it the Facebook effect or whatever you want to call it. We're kind of isolated in our own communities. We talk to people that, by and large, agree with each other. But there's larger things there, too, and this is one of them. I think when something like that comes up, it's important to point it out and recognize it. And it sets a direction for foreign policy. It's, again, maybe that is something that happens more readily at the local level within our communities. I certainly don't think Congress or our national leaders are using that as their guiding star today. It's quite the opposite. So.
No other comments on the discussion?
Roll call.
Okay.
Councillor Dwight.
Yes.
Councillor Klein.
Yes.
Councillor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councillor Murphy.
I abstain.
Councillor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councillor Shara.
Yes.
Councillor Spector.
Yes.
Councillor Adams.
Yes.
Councillor Carney.
Yes.
That passes in first reading and will be revisited for a second reading at our last meeting of December. Next up, we do have a second reading, and this is for the resolution regarding the payment in lieu of taxes program.
Waive reading, please.
And there's been a request to waive reading, which I will gladly grant. Is there a motion to put it on the floor?
Make a motion.
Second.
Been seconded. Further discussion on this issue? No. I've since heard from a few people almost all in support, some with some concerns, how this would be implemented, how it would be justly applied. But I think in the discussion last time it was made, it was understood, again, like all the other resolutions we just discussed, it doesn't carry the weight of law. It is an invitation, it's a request. Not unlike when we request citizens if they would consider an override. And for the most part, almost to a person, the ones that I talked with seem to feel comfortable with that. And that includes people who are associated with nonprofits. So I'd just like to say that I felt very comfortable with voting for this in the first round, and I have had nothing that would change my mind otherwise, so I'm considering voting. So without further ado, then, if there's no other discussion or questions or comments, is there a roll call request for this, or would
a roll call request?
Roll call request for Ms. LaBarge. So take it away, Pam.
Councillor Klein.
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
No.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Spector?
Yes.
Counselor Adams?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes. That passes in second reading. Next up, we have license and petitions. Originally on the agenda was the discussion pertaining to the Bottoms Road failed vote, and that was being brought forward by me. I've since a rereading, a proper reading of Robert's Rules of Order will not allow us, for me to propose a rescinded vote, so that won't be able to happen because it only applies if the vote were in the affirmative, if we actually accepted or enacted something. I'll be glad to discuss this. Counselor Spector, you get a buy on this. It probably won't come up again until
next year.
And the residents have been encouraged to repetition and for review and discussion, and I have offered to work with the residents to see if we can come up with a solution that works out for everyone. And then, so there's a possibility we'll be revisiting this next session for those of you returning. I'll accept a motion for the minutes of the previous meeting.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded. Any corrections, amendments? All those in favor of the minutes, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? we have a number of appointments here. This is to various committees to refer to the committees on rules, orders, and appointments and ordinances. For the Arts Council, we have Joshua Bedell of 264 Riverside Drive in Florence, and the term starts June 2015, expires June 2018. This is a reappointment to a second term. We also have George William Myers of 145 South Street, term to begin June 2015, expiring June 2018, reappointment to a second term. Eric Olson of 201 Park Hill Road in Northampton, term beginning May 2015, expiring June 2018, again, also reappointment for a second term. Jan Ruby of 51 Fairview Avenue, the term starting June 2015, expiring June 2018, reappointment for a second term. Catherine Service of 19 Butler Place, the term to start 2015, expire June 2018, also a reappointment to second term. And then I would also include in the Board of Almoners, Andrea Murray, 54 Day Avenue, Northampton. The term starts November 2015, expires June 2018. This is also a reappointment. Is there a motion to move them as a group?
So motion.
Okay. Any discussion on the referral? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? And now we go into recess, and Councilor Murphy presides over the finance.
Okay, you call the roll.
Counselor Murphy?
Here.
Counselor Adams?
Here.
Counselor LaBarge?
Here.
Counselor Shara?
Here.
First order would be approving our minutes of the November 19th meeting.
Move to approve them.
Second.
Second. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Vote. So for financial orders.
I will apologize.
The first one is upon the recommendation of the mayor. Whereas the Disability Commission has identified a need for a bench with a commemorative plaque at the Northampton Senior Center for the benefit of elderly and disabled persons, and whereas the Disability Commission voted to recommend the purchase of a bench and plaque to the mayor and further voted to fund the purchase from its Disability Commission fund, and whereas the mayor has approved the Disability Commission's recommendation, therefore be it ordered that the City Council approves an expenditure from the Disability Commission fund established under Chapter 40, Section 22G, and funded by handicap parking violations, not to exceed $1,750 for the purchase of a bench and commemorative plaque for the senior center. Do we have a motion on this?
I make a motion.
Second.
Second. All right. Councilor LaBarge, you're familiar with this, I assume.
Yes. We approved this at our meeting in November on the Disability Commission. And our reasons for that is because the need of the benches in Florence which I have to thank the two councilors for working very hard on those open public hearings to make that happen. We also looked at the senior center of many people with disabilities, the young that come, the elderly, people who come off the vans, and I've seen them where they'll get off the vans and it takes them a while just to get to the doors. And we thought it would be nice for our commission to donate a bench from our commission to anybody with disabilities or anybody coming and wants to sit. So that's what this is all about.
Any questions, Councillor?
And does the plaque just say that it's from the Disabilities Commission?
It's, yeah, exactly. Yep.
Any other questions on this one? All in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right, the next is upon the recommendation of the mayor, order that $1,200,000 be appropriated from the FY16 General Fund Undesignated Fund Balance, popularly known as free cash, to the following accounts: $600,000 to the Capital Stabilization Fund and $600,000 to the Regular Stabilization Fund. Do we have a motion? And
so moved.
Motion.
Second. Okay. And the mayor's here to speak.
Yes, councilors. So, as you know, each year when we close out the fiscal year, there's a process that takes place of all of our various accounts being rectified and closed out. And then at the typically toward the end of the year, November, December, the state notifies us, certifies what our undesignated fund balance is, or the term free cash as it's often referred to. And so I guess while everyone was shopping on Black Friday, the DOR was sending out emails to people about free cash, because we got an email on Friday, November 27th, from them, giving us our certification. So our general fund free cash was certified at $3,422,570, which again is a very strong and positive number. I think, as I've told you in the past, the DOR recommends that communities strive to be somewhere between 3% and 5%. This is 3.9%, so we're it's a good, healthy free cash balance. And so what I'm proposing to do, and as you know from past years, we typically allot some of that free cash toward our capital program. So we'll be using some of that to fund the capital program for this coming year. Obviously, we also want to keep some of it in reserve because it may snow this winter, and we may need to use it for the potential to replenish our snow and ice accounts. And so what we're proposing in this order, though, is to take 600,000, move 600,000 of it into our two primary stabilization funds, our capital stabilization fund and our stabilization fund, again, which has been our practice over time. And so that's basically the order.
Any questions from anyone, the mayor, on this? It's good news we have the funds for unexpected, particularly in the winter after last year.
Exactly.
What was last year like? Almost $1 million, wasn't it, for snow and ice? 907.
Yeah. It was definitely a tough winter. I will say that we, you know, one of the things I think that we have also seen over, you know, the last fiscal year, the one prior to that, is it's pretty much been snow and ice that we've had to use our free cash for. We haven't had to go back and do transfers for things like, you know, legal and veterans, because we've sort of built those up in the budget to be truer reflections of what we need. So it's pretty much primarily at this point, knock on wood, it's snow and ice, and then just any other emergencies that might occur. But the other major benefit to the free cash is that it allows us to fund the capital program. So probably $1.2 million we're going to probably dedicate from that fund toward capital projects in the upcoming year.
And that includes the street paving that
everybody indeed.
Likes. So
yes,
everybody
indeed.
Likes.
Yep.
Any other questions for the mayor on this one? All in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No. Great. The next one is also on the recommendation of the mayor. Order that the City Council approve a $250 budget for the Youth Commission to be used for supplies, meeting expenses during fiscal year 2016, said expenditures to come from the Mayor's Youth Commission Gift Fund. We have a motion on this one?
So make the motion.
Second? All right. Comment on this one?
Well, again, the Youth Commission, which does such great work throughout the year, typically we try to allot them a budget to be able to do activities, copying, pizza for meetings, things like that. Councilor
Dwight. Is that why Councilor Dwight is the liaison to the Youth Commission?
So anyway, this is something that we traditionally do every year, and so we want to be able to take some of the money that's already gifted to the Youth Commission and allow them access to it for the upcoming, to get them through the rest of the school year.
Any other questions on the pizza?
No, my joke, I was going to make a
joke. You do have to abstain from voting on this one.
I was going to make a similar joke, so you already said it.
Joke. I would... If I may, I'd like to say that actually this is money that the Youth Commission has generated over the years through a number of benefit programs, and that I'd also like to remind the community that the Youth Commission, in addition to co-sponsoring the most recent resolution that we discussed, also did Benchwalk, which actually I think was a remarkable achievement and will be repeated, and it didn't generate money for this fund. So this fund is actually, this is something they did as fundraisers for it. They did arts programming, they did party, a dance. And right now, the truth of it is I'm paying for the pizza out of my pocket at this point, so I'm just, whatever you can do to help.
So all in favor of a positive recommendation in finance, please say aye.
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 Opposed? No. Good. And that's all on the agenda. Is there any other new business that was unexpected?
You missed one. You've got a... the Water Enterprise Stabilization Sewer. Yeah. It's got a few pennies in it.
That one good. Get stuck together. Youth Commission. That one. We did that one. Oh, there's Water Enterprise. It gets stuck to the back of the other one. Also on the recommendation of the mayor. Boy, we missed those enterprise funds. We'd be in big trouble. Upon the recommendation of the mayor, order that $2,187,924 be transferred from the Water Enterprise retained earnings, or their version of free cash, to the Water Stabilization Fund, and that $4,160,219 be transferred from the Sewer Enterprise retained earnings into the Sewer Stabilization Fund. We have a motion?
So moved. Make a motion. Second.
Okay. I'm sure you have comment on this one.
Well, again, this is also part of this, of the notification we received from DOR. When it comes to enterprise funds, they call it retained earnings, but it's essentially the same thing, free cash. You may recall at the end of the last fiscal year, we did set up stabilization funds for water and for sewer enterprise. We didn't actually move their retained earnings at the end of last year into it. So this actually represents kind of an accumulation over the last two fiscal years, but we do want to now move these retained earnings into those stabilization funds so that when we move forward with capital projects and other, primarily capital projects, that that's a source that we would use to be able to fund those going forward. We are leaving some a balance in those funds, sort of like we keep a balance in our own free cash retained earnings funds. So we are keeping a balance. I think it's we're trying to maintain 10%, using that as kind of a metric, 10% of their operational costs to have, again, as a buffer and for emergencies. But we want to move the excess into these stabilization funds so that we will, again, build them up and have access to them for capital projects.
Questions for the mayor on this one? No. And these funds, too, I mean, we talked earlier about streets and how popular they are. When you redo a street, I mean, these funds contribute to the infrastructure in the sense that some of the money from water goes into water lines in a new street, and sewer goes into sewer lines. So there's a couple different pools that contribute funds for street work.
Definitely.
This gets used for that.
Yep.
All right. Any other questions? All in favor of a positive recommendation for this one in finance?
Aye.
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 Aye. Any opposed? So that really does.
I did actually want to add, if I just had a, I was I was going to do this in communication from the mayor, but I also, I didn't want it, it didn't seem appropriate with all the other things that were happening, so I was going to just sort of report to you about that, about this in finance. We have been working on the tax recap and submitting all that information to DOR, but one of the things that happened this week was that the assessor had our free growth, our new growth certified for FY16. So again, that means any new taxable, either residential or commercial, that came online during the last fiscal year, which we get to apply to the calculation under Proposition 2.5 toward our tax base under new growth. And so I'm really excited that new growth is continuing the trend, the upward trend that it's been on for the last 3 years, and has come in at 938,241. So, and that's about a 2.5% increase over last year, and then the year prior it was about $700,000. And to give you some perspective, you know, when the economy was bad, 2010, new growth was $375,000. So we're really pleased about that. I think it shows a lot of the continued economic investment that's happening. You know, we had that flurry on King Street, but then we've also continued to have investments like the hotel on Conn Street, like the work that's happening up at Village Hill, the assisted living and all the housing up there. So this is a positive sign for us, and it obviously helps our tax base immensely. So I wanted to make sure you knew about that.
Mm-hmm. And just for a reminder for people watching this at home, the $900,000 in new growth, it are the tax dollars generated
exactly.
by the value of that new growth. And for that fiscal, it was a tax rate like 1630-something? Yeah, for...
50, it was 1580, I think.
15? Yeah. Oh, it's at 16 this year, so. Figure, take that 900,000 times $15, and that's the value of the growth. So it was substantial real estate value that generated that. And what in that year, what was the 2.5 that year? Had to be close. So
yeah.
So it's getting near giving us the kind of funds that our 2.5 uptick is. So it's substantial. So
we look back to, I don't know, the records on DOR go back to 1992, and we never had new growth in the 900,000 range. Obviously, there's been inflation over time, but
good news.
But yeah, so it's a positive sign.
So with that, any other new business in finance? Hearing none, a motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
All in favor?
Okay. Thank you. Thank now you. We return to our regularly scheduled programming, already in process. We'll go back to doing these financial orders, Councilor O'Donnell.
I just wanted to ask if there's any interest in taking some out of order. I think Director Fiden might be here for the complete streets.
Is that conform with the council's will? Okay, sure thing.
So I'd move the complete. I think it's item E.
Which items do you want to bring up first?
I just item E, I think. If I had to guess, that's what I would guess you.
That's under order, so.
Oh, we can't skip that far ahead?
Well, we can.
It's a double hop.
It's a double skip that's moving into the.
Just an idea.
But no, that. No objections?
No. Yes, it's.
Doing Wayne a favor that he'll remember.
Yeah.
So item E is what you want for on the second reading, or there's also, Wayne can speak to several of these other issues. Not the least of which is pertaining to glass to insurance structures exempt from review, minimally maintain the existing amount of glass on street facing facades.
Hey, you said it, not me.
It was just one of my favorites. But
I just recall the questions, I think in particular from Councilor Klein from on complete streets. Maybe okay. I just keep my mouth shut.
So why don't we, if everyone's okay with that, we'll move to item E in orders. It's the ordinance pertaining to a complete streets policy, and this will be this for the second reading. I'll accept the motion and put it on the floor. A second?
Second.
Okay. So Wayne, you're recognized, and this did come up, and Councilor Klein did have some questions, and that if you be so kind. And Councilor Klein, hit it.
Well, wasn't that I had specific questions. Everything here is, you know, things that I would support, absolutely. It was more that I was taken aback by the format and just wanting to be clear and hear some reassurance from you that, in fact, I mean, there's a lot here, and there are very specific things, and I was just concerned that the city, in fact, were creating ordinance here. Is the city, in fact, able to ensure that we're going to be able to meet all of these specifications?
Sure, yeah. So the point is that we use the term default position. The point is to say this is the default position of city council and the city that we include all these items. And the idea is the Transportation and Parking Commission is a policy level committee. They're not supposed to be involved with approving individual projects. But so the default position is if a project goes forward on a city street, either by the city or private developer, that meets all those things, then it just goes forward exactly what projects do now without a detailed review. There will be times, as I think you're saying, that we can't do those things, that the right-of-way isn't wide enough, their slopes are too steep, whatever it is. And so there's a procedure that's in here that says then it has to go before transportation and parking. So transportation and parking can waive any of these things, but the goal is always to make it easier to do the right thing and more difficult to do the wrong thing. So if something doesn't happen, it goes before the committee and you serve on it, you guys can waive those requirements.
Councilor Murphy.
Have you guys done a financial analysis of what the impact of this is going to be?
We haven't done a financial analysis. So that was sort of the back and forth, the internal discussions we had in the city. We've had a policy on the books for 8 years now about doing complete streets. So we're already doing most of the things that are here. We were, I think, the first community in Massachusetts that was listed as being a complete streets community. And then a couple of things happened last year, three things happened last year that made us want to come back to you. One is MassDOT is giving away money for complete streets improvements for communities that have a complete streets policy. And we obviously want to get that money. That's probably a one-time allocation. The first year it's $100,000, maybe more if other communities aren't using their money. So it's not a huge sum of money, but it's real money. So we want to make sure we're eligible. The second thing is that the Complete Streets Coalition, the people who honored us as being the first complete streets in Massachusetts, is now saying, well, Northampton has it as a policy, which is aspirational, not as something that's actually more than aspirational. So they've sort of dropped us from their top list, and we want to be back. And it made us think about what's the difference between a policy that doesn't really mean that much and something that's stronger. And the final thing is that I think most of you know we went through the STAR communities, which is a nationwide assessment of sustainability. And they basically made the same statement. They said, it's great that you're aspirational, but we know it doesn't really mean anything. We think if you really want to be sustainable, you should give it stronger language. So that's what sent us here. But again, we've been doing most of these things. Most of the discussion, the things which wasn't clear in the original policy, is what happens for a mill and overlay. We know, and this has been our policy for 8 years we've been following, when we do a full depth reconstruction, we're adding sidewalks. What we don't know is exactly what happens for mill and overlay. So the language here is basically saying, in these areas, Journey to downtown, Journey to Florence, Journey to school, if we're doing a mill and overlay, we're gonna add sidewalks. Anywhere else in the city we're doing a mill and overlay, we won't necessarily add sidewalks. So I think it's not necessarily a change in policy as much as making it really clear and reaching that consensus, which makes it hard to price, frankly.
One of the policies talks about prohibiting private streets, and yet we're making some of those as we go along here. How do we reconcile that we have a policy that says no private streets, but we're...
So what we're talking about private streets isn't an ownership issue. It's a close the public issue. So Emerson Way, for example, is a private street. The city doesn't have to plow it. The city doesn't have to maintain it 20 years from now when it falls apart. But as part of that acceptance, as part of the approval for subdivision, they agreed to give an easement so the public has the right to go on the property. So that's what we're trying to get is, frankly, we're trying to avoid gated communities in Northampton. It's not a matter of who plows it.
So in other words, you're saying it doesn't have an impact on the streets that we might refuse to take.
Right.
It's something that's been on our table.
Right. It's really more about gated communities.
It talks about avoiding street widening and additional lanes that will induce new traffic. But what impact does it have where there's already congestion, adding turn lanes, you know, like what the state did to redo the intersection of Bridge Road and North Maple. I mean, sometimes we say you do the intersection on your nickel, and that kind of thing happens. I mean, where do you draw the line between inducing new traffic and relieving congestion of the traffic that's already there?
Yeah, yeah. This is not my expertise, but there are methodologies that we use for doing that. So when we go for something called congestion mitigation air quality, which is one of the main sources we get for intersections, the assessment that PVPC does is, are we reducing, improving air quality by reducing congestion, or are we going to make it worse by attracting new traffic?
So you reduce the queue time, traffic moves more slowly, they're not sitting and idling, and, you know.
Right, so the reason we love roundabouts is roundabouts are great at reducing congestion, right.
Relative to curb radiuses, that could make sense. Looking at curb radiuses for larger trucks, does that not cause a problem at some point with moving vans? I mean, sooner or later, it's my personal hope that a moving van goes to everybody's house once in a while. That said, do we want to create neighborhoods where moving vans are running over people's lawns because they can't negotiate their way?
So moving vans and fire trucks, the two things we think about. So the issue, let me go back. The issue is, in an ideal world, everybody stays in their lane. When you're turning right, you stay in the lane, you don't go into oncoming traffic. But the problem is, trucks are a very small percentage of the roads. And so if we make roads safe so that moving vans and fire trucks never leave their lane, we make curves that have very gradual, you know, radii, which makes really long distance for pedestrians. And so that's what we're trying to avoid. If the occasional moving van and the fire truck have to go in the left lane, that's not a problem. We've all seen this. We've seen it in lots of neighborhoods. The moving van has to go in the left lane for 20 feet and then back. That's not a problem. And so moving vans and fire trucks would just take the lane. We want to make sure that the routes that trucks go all the time, they don't have to leave the lane. So that's really what the language is about for this. Okay.
And then there's another one that says, where no sidewalk exists, traffic signal equipment should be installed that will allow for future pedestrian signalization. What's the difference in, I mean, I'm assuming you want to put in equipment that's capable of having that added. Do you have any idea what the cost difference is on that?
I don't know in terms of the cost. I know that the computers, what's called the controller, that's the same. We're almost always buying the most modern controller, so it's just the signals themselves. This comes up, frankly, I don't want to sound like the state's money doesn't matter. It all matters. But most new signals are being done by the state and not by the city. And so what happens is, we're putting a signal in and then we're forever making it hard to upgrade. So at the intersection of Earl and East Hampton Road, for example, that was done without that sort of equipment, and that means it's being incredibly expensive to add it later. So the marginal cost for a project is very small to put conduit in the street. And again, I want to say, like, it doesn't matter, but we're not talking about Chapter 90 money, because we're almost never using our money for a signalizing intersection. It's usually state project. We want to say that's what we expect for this project.
And again, if we, like, you know, thank goodness eventually the state's going to get around to Damon Road and King North, you know, King Street. If it's their project, this really doesn't have any effect on them, does it? They do pretty much what they want to do.
As a legal answer, yes, they do pretty much what they want to do. As a practical matter, MassDOT always asks both planning and DPW for comments, and they tend to respect those comments. So I think it does matter, and you usually follow it. If it's in opposition to something that they're doing, you're right, they're not going to do it. You know, if it violates some state rule. But if it's a matter of the state says we want you to, the city says we want you to put conduit in, so we might signalize it later, they're willing to do that kind of thing.
And my last question was about sidewalks. When that came to capital improvements recently, there was an overwhelming comment from them that new sidewalks are great, but with the available money, we need to look at the condition of some of the existing sidewalks. Here we're saying we've got to be building sidewalks to get things approved, and yet, you know, the funding source said, oh, by the way, don't forget the existing sidewalks that are in terrible condition. How does that reconcile itself?
So that's why the discussion, which has, so the original draft that's going back 8 years was sidewalks everywhere, and that's great, but exactly right, we have to set priorities. So that's why the focus was specifically on what are those areas where we really desperately need sidewalks, the journey to school and the journey to village areas. Those are the areas where I think the consensus is it's worth investing the extra money in peace. But you're right, we're not going to get sidewalks ever on Audubon Road. It wouldn't be the most effective use of our funds.
All right, thank you.
Councilor Klein?
Actually, you said something about being downgraded because it's policy, not ordinance, and there's some question, and that actually brought me back to kind of looking again at the language and being concerned that there's a lack of precision in the language, and if we're passing this as ordinance, and there is that lack of precision, I think that it could open us up to liability. And some of the examples are this use of the word should. Curb extensions should be installed, should utilize short block lengths. I mean, it sounds kind of like recommendations, policy, but it doesn't sound like ordinance. And I'm just concerned that we're going to pass this as ordinance when the language is soft. And what happens if, you know, people are coming with requests for variances or whatever else? It's just, I'm concerned about the language, I guess.
So the way we're trying to do this is Section A, the first section of it, says these are the policies. These are the things that aren't shoulds, they are shalls. And that includes the last one, number 11, which says here's all the design elements which have to be part of a project, unless transportation and parking waives it. And then a section B is the specifics that do require site detailed assessment. But we think the teeth is really largely in A, and particularly A11. That's the one that's saying you shall put sidewalks in, appropriate traffic calming measures, bicycle and pedestrian facilities. What the appropriate traffic calming measures are and what the appropriate bicycle and pedestrian facilities, they have to be done on a case-by-case basis. It's hard to do dispelling out those details.
So that means the shoulds remain equivocal, it sounds like, and I'm just wondering if it's appropriate that they're in ordinance, in fact, if it's an equivocal kind of directive.
So the reason we think it's important is, again, you have that section before the 11, which says we're going to have these things, and then it's to give it to explain what that means. It's still going to require a case-by-case assessment for each one. But it sort of, again, goes back to that default position. We're saying we want to start this. Let me give you one more context in case this is useful, and I guess we might as well announce this as any other time. The city's received a lot of grant money recently to help us with a series of plans. So we received about $100,000 to do a bicycle and pedestrian master plan. We're out to bid now. We're in the process of selecting a bidder for that. And then we received an additional $50,000 to do intense outreach for low-income communities who are typically not part of the planning process, to make sure they're very involved in the planning process, to embrace them. It's a regional grant, so this $150,000, most of it's for Northampton. There's a little work in for other towns. And so what I hope you all do is adopt this tonight and expect this is our policy over the next 9 months. When this plan is done, the plan goes before transition parking, goes to DPW, then I fully expect we'll come back with the, you know, having learned from this plan, and we probably will be more specific about things. But for now, I think this is useful to make a clear statement for what our default position is.
Councilor Klein, you're all set? Mm-hmm.
Any questions for
Councilor Klein? Well, actually, on number 11, actually, it's loaded with shoulds, just to be clear. So, and I take Councilor Klein's point. Should those shoulds be shall?
That one, I think I agree with you. Yes, I think for 11, they should be shall. For B, I think it's
right, because mill and overlay projects should include sidewalks on priority areas.
Yes.
The low current and potential demand should be made only with transportation parking approval. You want us to amend those to say shall?
Just for paragraph 11, yes.
For paragraph A and number 11, I don't see other shoulds. We'll do a word search. But I think, yes, number 11, which, as you said, was the most emphatic one, should probably have language that's more precise. And I think Councilor Klein's correct. I mean, we are making law here, so the law shouldn't have squishy language.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll accept amendment, actually, to that, if somebody wants to do that.
To amend.
Make an amendment.
Oh, now I have to say it. Right. Mill and overlay projects shall include sidewalks. And then, next sentence, very low current and potential demand shall be made only Transportation and Parking Commission approval.
Is there a second on that amendment?
Second.
Fight for the second? Councilor Carney beat you both to it, so Councilor Carney gets a second. Get your little second award. Discussion on the amendment. All those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. All right, back to the original order. Thank you, Wayne. Any other discussion on these points? Councilor Murphy brought us some excellent points, and I'm glad you asked those questions, and thank you. Roll call, please.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Sector?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Okay, scroll back up the page, or flip if you have paper. We're back, coming out of the Finance Committee, and our first order is 15.543, the financial order to approve the expenditure from the Disability Commission Fund to purchase a bench and plaque at the Northampton Senior Center not to exceed $1,750. The first reading, is there a motion?
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion on this? Did I go backwards? Just go in the order of some lady handed me this thing. Just go, just doing your dark bidding. So, you ready for the roll call?
Yeah.
Well, let's do it.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Spector?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Now we have 15.546. This is the financial order that $1,200,000 appropriated from the FY16 general fund be transferred to the capital stabilization fund and stabilization fund, $600,000 each. This is first reading.
Move first reading.
Motion's made and seconded. Any further discussion on this item? I just like to point out that we are in much better shape than a lot of surrounding communities. And I think that's, there's been some very good proper management of our fiscal house. And that's to the mayor's credit and Susan Wright's credit. So the should be acknowledged, particularly, and also the growth. We are experiencing stuff that other communities would be extremely envious about. Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Spector?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
That passes first reading, and we will revisit it again at the next council meeting. 15.547, financial order, the free cash be transferred into the Water Stabilization and Sewer Stabilization Fund. This first reading. Motion?
So moved.
Seconded. Discussion on this. Ready?
Yep.
Roll call, please.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Spector?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
That passes in first reading. Item 15.548, the financial order to approve the $250 budget for the Youth Commission to be used for supplies and meeting expenses during fiscal year 2016. This is the first reading. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All right. Let's get a little worried there.
she took $10.
Wait, are we gonna, am I gonna lose this vote?
Yeah.
Any discussion?
How often do you have pizza?
We just had it last night, actually, for the first time in this, with this session. And yes.
I think in the new council, everybody's gonna ask to be on the youth commission.
Yeah, well, that's true. There's a downside. I come working from a pie shop and go eat pizza.
There is an issue of precedent setting.
It's true. It's true. I don't know what to say. It should be said that I am enormously proud of the youth commission. Anything we can do to sustain them with food, I'm all for. So. Any other discussions? Any other snappy comments? Okay. Any pizza requirements or anything like that? Councilor Klein's trying to suggest something. I don't know what.
Just another commission.
Oh, you'd like to amend it to provide the Transportation Parking Commission with pizzas.
You guys have to develop your own funding stream. These guys did, I should say. Okay. roll call, please.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor White.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sharon.
Yes.
I was just thinking, maybe I should abstain. I do benefit. Okay. We have the financial order. This is 15.538, financial order to appropriate a bequest, and this is second reading, by the way, of $14,646.30 from the Hannah Hopp estate to various purposes in the second reading. Made and seconded. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sharon.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Next up, we have item 15.540. This is the last financial order. It's to acquire for conservation purposes any easement or conservation restriction for the Hampshire Courthouse owned by the Hampshire Council of Governments on the corner of Main and King Streets. Accept a motion.
Move to approve.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sharon.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Now we're into orders and ordinances. 15.541, this is City Council rules for 2016 to 2017. This is for their next session, and this is second reading. I'll accept the motion.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Discussion. Councilor Murphy, the Councilor Spector.
I just have a question, because I was not here at the last meeting when you had your way with these for the first time at council. And the version that I got tonight of the ones with the edits, for some reason, only had the odd numbered pages 1, 3, 5, 7, 9.
I think that's because those are the only pages that contain those changes, and I don't. Then you, is that? Because I have that too.
Oh, I can't imagine. Yeah. I also have with all the odd numbered pages.
Electronically,
these
it's
are the odd numbers.
Yeah, I have.
No
I have prime
numbers.
The PDF document is fine.
Yeah. Sorry about that. In my haste to make copies of what Councilor O'Donnell was suggesting for tonight, you didn't get the even number pages.
I could do those next year if you want. Councilor,
I
believe you back to back and skip the even number pages.
I believe you have a version as passed on first reading, and then there's the second one, which is just technical amendments I was going to suggest tonight, and that's the one that's missing half of itself. So yeah, but you probably have the other one. So if
I've got the original one.
Okay.
It's complete, but not the one that reflects your good work from the last council meeting, I guess.
Well, that one does reflect our work from the last council meeting that's complete. And maybe when it comes time, I would like to offer just a few technical amendments. Maybe we can put that on the screen and work from that.
I would also like to point out that everybody did get this emailed to them this afternoon, so
okay,
it should be the right way.
So why don't we put up on the screens our new magic screens? The
reason I brought that up is just if you you know, because Councilor Donalds could have been the keeper of this. Could you let me know as a result of the last council meeting, you know, not Scribner stuff, but what substantial changes were made, you know, just as we go through it?
Absolutely. As we go through it, does that mean we're going to read it?
I
can try and summarize. Yeah, many amendments were proposed by Councilor Adams. Many of them were deletions. So
I guess I'd be the most interested in the ones that live on the even numbered page.
You should have another. Well, you know, for one, I'll just summarize briefly from last time. The number of members of each committee was increased to 4 for all members of the committee, and that affected legislative matters and the Committee on Public Works.
Only a couple were three, right?
Exactly, just those two.
Yeah,
yep. I think we made technical correction on how the solicitor would potentially weigh in on ordinances, the issue of rotating the independent auditor and having that be done every 5 years as a matter of policy was stricken, so that's not in this version. And there was a lot of other debate. I'm trying to recall, maybe other councilors can help me, of the debate that actually there was debate on the agenda, although we retained it in the end in some form. We did modify it.
The rule about councilors attending committee meetings, mm-hmm. we struck. Not non-councilor attendance
right.
at committee meetings.
Non-member
attendance. Non-member
right.
councilor
right.
attendance.
Okay.
We struck that.
So we could rely on state law. And, mm-hmm. Yeah. The council president's suggestion, we'll no longer approve minutes that come to us from our committees. We'll just rely on them to
just accept them.
We won't even do that.
Accept them, but it's kind of absurd because for our benefit, it's not something that.
And there's no
what happens if we
doing that.
Reject them would seem kind of silly.
There's still minutes.
Right, exactly.
I think that, and we also made a technical change, the automatic carryover provision, which I can get into if necessary, but we had a provision in there that would actually kind of just make us do it the way we are currently doing it, and we're not trying to do it. We're trying to save some time, so we tweaked that as well. I think that summarizes the major changes. Others can jump in if I'm missing something. Yeah.
There was the 3-day.
Good one, yeah.
Right.
The 3-day thing.
And that's in your current amended version right now, isn't it?
That's been accepted, yeah. Yep.
That was one of the amendments we accepted.
We had a strange rule. I hope you don't mind my jumping in here.
No, please.
We had a strange rule requiring 3 days' notice. It wasn't clear what that notice was or to whom or what form it would take before we amended the rules. That's what we have currently in our current rules. So we said, well, let's just have 48 hours like everything else. That was a change as well. So. Yeah.
So do you want to proceed with...
Well,
essentially, as you said, they're technical changes.
Mostly, I'm happy to listen to comments from other council respect if you have some amendments or discussion, or I can just go through the technical ones first if that's.
Councilor Spector, what's your pleasure with it? Okay. Why don't
should we dispense with that?
Yeah.
Okay. So I would move an amendment as embodied in what's on the screen. And I'll just very as quickly as possible summarize it. First of all, we've been calling these the rules and orders. I don't know what the and orders part is. I think that's holdover from something. I think it should just be rules. So this amendment just proposes to make all the instances of rules and orders rules. On page 2, you can see it corrects something in the index. We automatically recognize department representatives, not just the heads of the representatives. Or the table of contents, rather. On page 3, You can see, which is an odd-numbered page, so you'll be able to refer to it. You can see that the instances of rules and orders have been changed. There are some, you know, capitalization things going on there. On page six, in many instances.
Page three, presiding officer change.
Oh, yeah, that's just for capitalization.
Okay.
Yeah, format,
okay.
Yeah.
Sorry.
On page six, our administrative assistant called this to our attention. Currently, these are some of the duties of the administrative assistant, and it was to secure two videos of meetings. We're adding of the city council and its committees that were so recorded, so she won't have to find videos of meetings that weren't recorded. On page seven, which makes a lot of sense, on page seven, under Committee on Community Resources, there it is, just adding the housing partnership, and I propose moving parking enforcement as a department that this committee will explicitly deal with, parking enforcement to city services. That seems to make more sense. And thank you for your patience in entertaining these technical things as we try and polish this up. On page eight, there's a missing word, so it's going to be amended to read, requests to appear before committees. A committee may make, that was the word I was missing, a committee may make information requests pursuant section 2.7 of the charter. On page 10, there's a more substantial amendment. This has to do with select committees. The text that is added, as you can see, is such committees may make recommendations and may sponsor ordinances, resolutions, or other matters. I thought it was important to have that explicit, that these committees can actually do something and make recommendations. Mm-hmm. And equally, I think that citizen members of these select committees should be voting members. I think that's part of their purpose, is, yeah. But also, I added, in the case of city employees, when they may serve on select committees, that provided the mayor, of course, approve the appointment of a city employee. That seems reasonable as well.
Go over those two with the solicitor, because I wonder, subcommittees are council subcommittees. I'm wondering if it is legal to have a non-councilor vote in a councilor subcommittee. And I'm also wondering if it's legal, you know, to actually, I understand that the mayor has to allow the appointment. I see that, so it's not mandating that the council, you know, requires a city employee over which it doesn't really have direct jurisdiction. Mm-hmm. But was that run by the solicitor?
Excellent questions. The first one absolutely was. I had the same thought. Can we have a citizen member vote on the same level as a councilor? The solicitor's response was, doesn't see why not. And I suppose that stands to reason when I think about it, especially because these committees are making recommendations or advisory in a sense. So that's the answer on that. On approval by the mayor, I could see your point. I did not run that by the solicitor. It just seemed like common sense. I suppose if you wanted to strike it, it would still be, as a practical matter, the same thing. I mean, city employees are not going to start serving on committees unless the mayor says it's okay. So if you were concerned about that, that would be reasonable.
I didn't know if the city solicitor, was a very different reading of the charter than I do, would deem that to be the creation of a multiple member body, which we can't do. So I'm just curious.
On that particular point, he didn't convey that opinion to me. Yeah. Yeah, I would still hope that these would be principally council committees. Okay. Further down the state legislative agenda, I just, you know, I wanted to be clear. I heard a lot of the comments that were made at the last meeting and took them pretty seriously. So I just offer something that might improve this section, in particular in response to Councillor Klein, who asked a reasonable question. How would it actually work, this process of setting the agenda? First, the First Amendment is, instead of by December 1st, we will adopt an agenda in the form of a resolution. Perhaps it should just be consider a resolution. I don't think we can, because that's kind of saying we will vote yes on something, and if you see what I mean. So maybe that should just be consider as opposed to adopt, because we could certainly reject one too. And then it adds a sentence about doing this whole thing. For this purpose, the city council may establish a select committee to recommend a resolution. That just provides guidance about how we might go about sorting through state legislation and creating a resolution. Now, skip over a fair amount of pages. I believe the next amendment is on 17, page 17.
Which number is it?
It's 5.1.1, the timely filing rule. And again, you know, consulting with our administrative assistant about what's practical here, I just propose amending this to read, all orders, ordinances, resolutions, contracts, and any other written business to be transacted by the City Council shall be filed with the administrative assistant to the City Council by close of business 3 days prior to a regular City Council meeting, or at a later time subject to the discretion of the Council President and the administrative assistant to allow for review and timely posting. So in other words, you know, just so there's not a big rush at the end, please get it in by your proposal by close of business 3 days before, but we don't want to hem ourselves in. If we have in a measure we want to get on there at the last minute, we don't want to break the rules to do that. So that was the intent behind that amendment.
Councilor Adams.
Do the posting and agenda setting requirements of the open meeting law allow this?
This actually exceeds
48.
Yeah.
48 for open meeting, but right. but that 3 days can be it can be later than 3 days. So that's my concern. And if it's later than 3 days, say particularly within 48 hours, the council president and the administrative assistant shouldn't have the authority to allow for later submissions when the open meeting law doesn't.
I take your point. Yeah. As far as open meeting law, so within the 55-48 range, there is discretion, at least I think, and that should probably be made implicit as opposed to, you're right, it can't supersede the 48 hours.
With the 55, right.
Yeah, I take your point. With the provision, there's a distinction between filing and posting. But we could easily just add subject to the provisions of the open meetings law.
Add the word legal, timely and legal posting.
Yeah, or, you know, in accordance with the open meetings law or something like that. Yeah. Okay.
Well, perhaps
that. Do you make that as a friendly?
Please, yes.
Yeah. Sure. Thank you. What is the exact language?
In accordance with the open meeting law, right after.
Okay, excellent. That's great.
Thank you.
Page 19 has to do with the number of votes required for what matters, what kind of matters.
Which item?
I'm sorry.
5.5 and 5.6. Thank you.
On page 19. Generally, these next few things, I'm trying to get some terminology right. We often use the word reading. And I'm trying to create some uniformity and get away from using the word reading because the first time we have something in front of us, even if we just refer it, in some corners that's a reading of an ordinance or a matter. So I like to just have votes. You know, some things require two votes, some things require one vote, or one votes. And you'll see two formatting amendments there. But in 5.7, I do change the word readings to votes. And under automatic carryover on the next page, 5.8, amended to read, matters that have not passed the required number of votes by the end of the current session shall automatically carry over to the next, rather than
assume that everything requires two.
Yeah. And then
5.7.
And then below that, because of the change, 5.8.1 should be amended to read, a matter, this is an exception, that will not be subject to automatic carryover. A matter has already failed on the first of two required votes. You can see capitalization of council. And the final one is in the appendix under the special permit granting authority, pages 20 through 22, There are just two instances to correct it, to make a pronoun gender neutral. So it says there instead of his in two places.
Which Roman numeral?
Let's see. Roman numeral 4, subsection B and subsection G. I changed the word his to there, just to make it gender neutral. And that's all. That's the description of the technical amendments.
And Councilor Spector.
Well, two things. First, thank you very much for doing this. A lot of work, and even just going through it today, it's great. And I apologize. The second piece is somewhat. I apologize if maybe I'm. My mind was leaving a little prematurely. Councilor Adams called me today and alerted me to just kind of look at this a little more in the rules and one of the committee structures. And I called you about this. And I want to just say I apologize because it's not a minor change. And it might be that perhaps I will ask for to table this till the next meeting to have more discussion. But here was my concern in thinking about this. And again, I apologize because I should have done this before first reading, I just didn't. In thinking about the committee structure, I would like to make a suggestion. As someone who's was on both Public Works Committee Public Works Committee for my entire time on the council, which is almost 12 years, and on the Economic Development Committee during that time. Both committees, back before the new charter, were committees that were multi-member committees, so that the Public Works Committee, we had members of the Department of Public Works, we had people from Commission on Public Works, we had three councilors on there. I found it to be a very vibrant committee. Very rarely canceled a session. We always had a number of items on the agenda. Partially for us as councilors, we learned quite a bit because we had all of this information coming from a variety of people. There are three members of the BPW there, as well as usually two or three members of the DPW. So it was an 8 or 9 member committee, I believe. And again, it was a very vibrant committee with a lot of issues always moving through it, with often material. And some of those took many years, and you saw some of those, like the streets recommendations or the stormwater, all things that emerged from that committee. When that committee changed because of charter, and it became strictly the actual voting members were only from the council, I felt, and I was against that, as you remember, I felt, and even though I was chair of that committee, that committee lost a lot of its punch. We at many times didn't even have agenda items for that committee. And in the same way that to some extent that often happened with economic development as well. That economic development committee used to be chaired by the mayor. City planner was always there. Peg Keller from housing was always there. There were a couple of members from other committees like conservation and other people who would be interested in issues of economic development. So it became, again, it was a very vibrant committee that always had agenda items. When it became just a council committee, I felt the same thing happened, and we've had many meetings where we have no agenda items. With both of these committees, at times, I think that these could be committees, and I'm not making this suggestion, but I think each of them could probably be a committee that operated as a special appointed committee by the city council, because it becomes almost a project committee. Like Ed Lou right now, when he had the issue of what do we do with the roundhouse development? Well, there's a subcommittee appointed that has citizen members, and it becomes that specific item. And there were a couple of other items in Ed Lou like that. The same thing with Public Works. If we had the Public Works Committee and there was just a special committee saying, hey, look, we're needing to look at stormwater. We could have had a special committee to look at what we should do about stormwater and should there be stormwater fees. Because of that, my recommendation would be to have a committee, and again, if you'd like to discuss this more, and I'm also willing to let it go, but my suggestion would be, as we look at these new committee structures, would be to have one committee that is the Public Works and Public Safety Committee. Seems to make sense to me, because those are the three largest departments, so that would be fire, police, and the DPW. And that committee then, I think, would have enough on its plate consistently to make that a vibrant
committee. And sometimes, actually, the issues among those committees overlap. So sometimes in public works, we actually had to have input from public safety on many things, and vice versa. So it seems to make sense to me. And they're three of the largest of our departments. I would then allow for the, I know there were issues around affordable housing and other issues like that. A number of the issues that might have been under Ed Liu's preview, I would put those under a different committee structure or let those be separate appointed committees. I know that's a very broad suggestion that may require much more thinking. And if we could start the discussion tonight, and if you feel like it's too much, we can let it slide. If you feel like it's worth discussing more, I would be happy to sit down and we could talk a little more about that and have some more discussion and bring something clearer back to the council. Again, I apologize. So I'm happy to go either way on that.
That's right.
I agree. I look at the current committees and I appreciate that there are fewer and the purpose is to lead to efficiency, but I wonder if efficiency will result because the purviews of some of these committees are just extremely large, and it's difficult for me to envision how some of these meetings may function. Public safety, for example, is a committee that deals with various agencies, and we have some cancellations, but we meet most months, and there are a bunch of departments under its purview. And then you look at public works, for example, and it once, one time before the structure was changed due to the administrative orders, it was a vibrant committee, but now it's not really much of a committee. And if you look at it, it's just one committee that deals with one department. And I think there probably is room for merger. And I like the idea of taking public safety out because it is a big committee to merge into a committee that already seems to have merged Veterans Affairs, which was once merged before, and the Disability Committee and Libraries and a whole bunch of, it just seems like a really, 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 really packed and unwieldy committee to me. So I agree. I think that might actually function better that way.
Councilor Klein.
I'm glad this has come up because if you remember at the very first meeting we had about this change, I kept kind of looking at the committees as they had been set up and just something didn't sit right with me. What was classified where, resources versus services, doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me, but also just kind of throwing everything into one mm-hmm. committee. I mean, we actually experienced that with the Social Services Veterans SSVCR committee that we had, you know, five things under the purview of that committee, and it kind of created a sense of, you know, where do we go? What are we doing? What's the purpose? And I think that a lot of this structure will recreate that same kind of muddledness. So I agree with, and I also agree with both of the counselors that spoke about this, that when the structure changed, for instance, with the Public Works Committee, it just kind of disintegrated. It was a very vibrant committee that had a lot of learning, I think, back and forth. We brought constituent issues to people who worked at the DPW. They could weigh in on things. It was a very mutually informative process to be in those committee meetings. So, I understand that we have an issue that we can no longer create committees that have staff and that bring in citizens unless we do a special ad hoc thing, and I appreciate that you built that in. But the standing committees don't feel right to me, and I don't quite yet have a sense of what the solution might be. I'm not sure I agree with the solution that you put forward, Councillor Spector, but I agree with the problem, and I think we have to put a little bit more thinking into what's going to be useful for the council, for the city. I agree with that absolutely.
Just very briefly, because I would actually be interested in the chair of public safety's view as well, if we're talking about moving.
Well, I was just envisioning the merger of public safety and public works and imagining that to be too unwieldy, that those are both too, that trying to bring the two of them together might just really be too much on one committee. So I can also go along with the notion that that there can be some that some of this does feel like some of these are already too big and take on too many, but I don't think that the solution is merging public works and public safety, and I don't think that we can arrive at a solution to these tonight. I mean, I think that this may, you know, if there may be a way to maybe even meet over the next, before the next council meeting, if Councilor Spector wanted to meet with Councilors Dwight and O'Donnell, who put forward the thing, and look at something that might take care of that. Okay, but I really don't think that putting public safety and public works together, I think that that might be too much.
Would you want to just keep, it sounds like public safety, you would want to, as the chair, that you think that committee should stand alone? Because we're already adding, there'd be other additions, it seems to me, in that new structure. And I'm just asking, would your suggestion be that remain a standalone committee?
Again, what I don't have experience with the Veterans Affairs, Social Services, Libraries. I don't see those as necessarily having as much as Public Works, even all together those, I don't see them as having as much meat and matter as the Public Works.
So you would say you'd be okay to have public safety add some pieces to it, because I was getting the I was only asking a question because I was getting the sense that what you were saying is public safety is already a full enough committee. And therefore, why would we add anything more to it?
No, I was actually just saying what I said, which was that public safety and public works together would be too much.
Okay.
That's what I was saying.
But other, okay.
Councilor O'Donnell and Councilor Adams.
I just say, you know, Councilor Spector, sorry by apologizing a couple of times. And actually, that's the last thing you should do, because as you pull on the thread of this sweater, it keeps coming. Yeah. You come up with stuff you didn't think about before, so I actually appreciate the discussion even on second reading. I actually, on the matter of public safety, at this point I agree with Councilor Carney, and I'll tell you why, by way of explaining my intention. And it's interesting because I've heard that the goal is to increase efficiency and streamline. I've certainly read that in the newspaper, streamline. And there may be something there, but that wasn't my principal intention. I wasn't trying to just reduce our committees and pack them together. I was trying to group them, and I'm sure I did it imperfectly. I'm sure we can improve upon it. I was trying to group them according to a logic that was, let's have one that takes cities, all the things that the city does, many of the things that SSVCR deals with, and then public safety, because that's a very important public city service. And let's have a committee dealing with city services. And then the Economic Development Committee is more like everything else. You know, it's stuff that's important to the city, but not necessarily delivered by the city. By the way, we recently had an issue that may come up on the horizon about a taxi license that we may have to have an appeal for. And, you know, we're gonna have more for the Community Resources Committee to do that would include something like that. You know, review of petitions and licenses, hearings about them, and this kind of thing. And so that was my rationale for separating. I mean, that's why I thought public safety made sense to go under city services. And while and final word in the DPW committee is, or the Public Works Committee is, yes, it is such a massive committee. It's everything, and it's also utilities. That was my logic. So just to explain that.
Councilor.
I'm actually the only councilor who's on both of those committees, and have been the entire time I've been on the council. And I think you could quite easily merge them, just a difference of opinion. For example, it could be a committee that is, like some committees, no longer than 2 hours. For the first hour, you have a DPW issue, if there are any that month. And for the next hour, you have dispatch or the health department or the fire department for the other hour. And for those months that you have nobody, you could cancel, or maybe only have an issue of public safety or only an issue of DPW. I mean, I think it would be easily merged and it would make a lot of sense.
Oh, no, I did. I'll defer to, I haven't been on the Public Works Committee myself. It seems from the outside that there's a lot going on there, but I can respect that opinion.
As everyone's pointed out, part of the phenomenon that we're that's being described here is the diminution of responsibilities that were, because under the new administrative orders, there are no longer the multi-member bodies that included the executive and the council. That didn't change with public safety. So, the guiding principle here, of course, is now that these are our committees for us to refer and educate ourselves with, and to process the systems and the issues as they come before us, so that in more granular detail than just here. And so, you know, that's what I'm for, is for the most efficacious, most illuminating way that we can institute that. That'd be great. Councilor Spector.
I'm just going back to your suggestion that perhaps we should continue this discussion. I'd be happy to work with whoever. I don't know what the process would be, but you're suggesting some kind of process that we may take another look at this and come back at the next meeting. Now, I'm not sure what the...
We do have a clock ticking. Like. We have
clock ticking means it have to be voted on the next session.
That is my hope.
So my question is, what kind of, how would we actually do, what's in our purview to say, okay, what's the best way to go about doing that? And as I said, I'd be happy to work with whoever to come up with
I think suggestions. If you did that, you would have to do it in groups of two or three, and that's, or we could have a special meeting.
Special meeting or another ordinance meeting.
But the schedule's pretty tight, since we got 2 weeks, than 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm. Although ordinance does meet.
But you have an agenda already?
I just posted it today, but that doesn't mean it.
Well, it's not the 48-hour rule, so if you needed to
If you want to put that on that agenda.
What time do you meet?
What's it? Is this one at 6? It's a different. Did you make it 6, I think?
It's at 6 on Tuesday, is that right?
Yeah. Because we wanted to do it because we wanted to get those reappointments that we made tonight. We wanted to get them done before the end of the year. So
just a point of order, a question. You're 6 on Tuesday, this coming Tuesday? I could come from 6 to 6:45. Then I have a meeting scheduled with the Round Hill community. So I'm facilitating that. I need to be there before 7.
Well, in the interim, of course, that doesn't preclude you having conversations with other people, but you have to be careful of serial conversations.
Right, I won't do that. But a request would be if this could be near the head of the agenda, because I would need to leave. I can't. I could stay for like a half hour, a little longer.
6 on next Tuesday.
Okay.
6 on the 8th? Yeah. 6 o'clock on the 8th?
The 14th.
Okay.
Oh, it's the 14th.
You just said this coming Tuesday.
Oh, okay.
So
it's Tuesday before
the council meeting.
Okay.
That works for you?
Tuesday the 14th, yep.
There is no Tuesday the 4th. There's a Monday the 14th or a Tuesday the 15th. So I have on my calendar Tuesday the 15th at 6 p.m.
That's probably it.
Okay. Thank you.
It's Tuesday before
the council meeting.
Your transportation and parking.
Right after
is on the
15th? On Tuesday.
Okay, so that's the date. The 15th.
Six
Tuesday
o'clock.
Tuesday the 15th. Okay.
Tuesday at 6 o'clock.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Not Monday the 14th.
Tuesday. Okay. So, Councilor.
So if we were to refer it back to ordinance, it would have to come back to this committee, just the council.
Yeah.
And would it be subject to again two readings? I mean, we'd have to waive.
That's what I was just. I'm trying to. That's what I'm trying to suss out in my head. I'm not sure.
Isn't it the rule that the amendments have to be, if the amendments are substantive enough that they change the essence, that you have to have two readings? But if it's just an amendment, because we're working on an amendment.
I believe that only applies. I think I'm not sure if you agree with this. I believe that only applies to certain zoning ordinances.
And it doesn't apply to.
I don't believe that applies.
It doesn't. These are our rules, and that
we could pass a rule that our own rules don't need to reach.
Yes, or exempted from these rules. yes, and I.
But the
this is an amendment too.
This is an amendment. The only the portion that's being amended could be referred back to ordinance. Mm-hmm.
But there were councillors that had concerns about the committees, and those councillors should be able to participate in a discussion or a review, or I think just sending it to the three councillors as members of ordinance committee. We need to have the opportunity to hear those specific concerns and those specific recommendations, and that will raise the issue of the quorum, because there'll be at least a couple of other councillors.
We already did that, and we already addressed that. Councillor O'Donnell, did you?
I think two things.
Yeah.
These are the council's rules, and so the council should have as much discussion on them as they want, and if more discussion is required, and so if you were to do that, I think you should have a joint meeting of the council and the ordinance committee. But I also wanted to say, I don't think there's a perfect answer. There's no perfect, you know, format. I think we all acknowledge that, but we may have a meeting and still not agree, but maybe, yeah.
Councillor Murphy.
And the new rules do allow us to amend the new rules. If we get going and one committee's totally overwhelmed,
yes,
we just change the rules as we go along.
Councillor Connor.
I know you just said that we just dealt with that, and we just were.
That's what we dealt with the last time when we had the previous meetings and the previous discussions. So the other councillors present, it would have violated quorum, and it was posted as a joint.
So that's what we'll do to deal with this. Is we'll post this meeting that is Tuesday, December 15th, as a joint meeting.
Joint council and
15th.
So it'll be a joint meeting, and then councillors who have concerns about the committees and committee structure can all come, and we'll have that be.
The 15th.
Tuesday, December 15th.
In this chamber.
At 6 p.m., but we also have other items on the agenda, so it'll likely go until we'll deal with those first.
Oh, they're mostly appointments, because
that's right.
We have,
okay.
Being that it's, you know, it's we have one
year.
Council meeting left,
yeah.
Nothing of substance really got sent there, because it would never make it back. So
right.
I think it's primarily the appointments, right?
We have one straggling ordinance that we're actually. Is there one or two? You have the tree.
The tree.
The trees. What about the trees?
Yes. And then you have the still on your agenda. You'll need to sort of send it back to City Council, I guess, the sick time thing that was kicking around forever.
Which could be carried over.
That can be carried
over.
It'll
be a fun treat for the next council.
So, I would need an actual motion. Councillor Dell.
Before that motion, do we consider the amendments that I read out to be adopted kind of without objection?
Yes. Actually, why don't we discuss that? Because, are there any objections or questions about the proposed changes that Councillor O'Donnell, which were not substantive or related to the committee?
I just move it as
I'm gonna, yes, I'm just gonna others. Do that.
And you have some others? You have some others? Okay.
They're quick.
Do you want to add them as friendly amendments, or you want to do them separately?
I mean, sure, if they're accepted as such. One's a typo, I think. 2.6.2.3. 7 days has an apostrophe, and I don't think it needs one.
Got it. It's made it possessive.
Right. And the other simple one is, I think simple, but Rule 1.2, the second sentence, the latest version of the rule shall be published online. My understanding of the charter is that that's under the mayor's control, and we can't mandate that. So I move to strike that.
Could you explain?
Well, they certainly control it. I mean,
well, actually,
doesn't the city clerk have for real?
Well, the administrative assistant. I suppose by extension, it's IT. But the administrative assistant can post online.
Seconded? Did we make a motion?
I moved my amendments as written. Containing various friendly amendments, I think about two
and
from council.
I'm going to second
it. Okay. So there was only one. Was the apostrophe?
And there was, but there was one earlier that Councillor Adams made about the open meetings law.
Yeah.
And that was changed too.
Right, thanks.
And that's.
That's part of it.
We'll consider incorporating this amendment.
Okay, that's accepted as friendly amendment. So, the motion's made, is there a second?
I second it.
All right, so this is to the amendments. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Counselor Adams?
I have one more small amendment. We talked in the ordinance committee about taking new appointments out of the consent agenda. And I'd like to make that motion to keep reappointments in there and to remove new appointments from the consent agenda.
So there's a second on that amendment?
Second.
Okay.
For the point of discussion, could you explain that to me?
Yeah, we discussed an ordinance that, well, my point was I thought reappointments were kind of important and shouldn't be in the consent agenda. I mean, of course you could remove things from the consent agenda, but the point of the consent agenda is that minor things that typically require no discussion. And I thought that appointments were kind of important and should be taken out of that section. And then Councilor Murphy brought up the possibility that it may make sense to leave reappointments in there because they're typically without controversy and take new appointments out. So gotcha. That's my motion.
Because remember, we used to not, before the charter change, we used to not even refer reappointments.
Yes.
We used to just do them at the council meeting.
Yep.
And then we ended up having to refer them. And I thought the reason we did that was the new charter required. I think then the new charter said they all had to be referred.
I believe so. Yep.
Yes.
So, yeah, all appointments.
Because we used to refer the new ones and just do the reappointments at council. And then we had to refer them all because the new charter said they all must be referred someplace.
Yep.
Which would not, then it couldn't even go on the consent agenda. They'd all have to go. I mean, if I get that right. Is that correct?
Well, for the purposes of referrals, I think so.
Yeah, we'd have to, but when they came back, are we talking about referrals or are we talking about just where they go in the agenda?
We're talking about where they go.
Okay, so they're going to have to go out, but when they come back, the reappointments can go on the consent agenda because they're usually non-controversial.
Right.
I get the rationale behind it. I mean, I oppose that. I oppose making a distinction between appointments and reappointments. Reappointments are arguably as important to scrutinize if they indeed deserve scrutiny as appointments. But the reality is, the possibility for scrutiny is still there because, as Councilor Adams noted, if something's on the agenda, consent agenda that we wish to remove, we just remove it at the request of one councilor. Yep. In fact, it's a very gentle way of suggesting that we discuss something, you know. So I like it for that respect. And I also think that, I think we ought not to create the appearance of scrutiny. I think we ought to have real scrutiny. And that's achieved with the consent agenda. We shouldn't just always have it on the debate, on the agenda for debate, because I guarantee you 99% of them were just going to wave through in a perfunctory way anyway, I would imagine, from my limited experience.
So I'm just a little confused. Did you just have a debate with yourself and
I don't.
That's your position?
Did I?
I admire that.
Because
you No, you didn't. You stayed with being against Councilor Adams. I thought you were saying, as you think about it, that maybe we do let the reappointments go through. I just wasn't sure where your final position was on that.
I think all referrals of all appointments or reappointments should be on the consent agenda. And I think when they come back, they should stay in the consent agenda.
Okay.
And in particular, maybe this was what was confusing. I don't see a difference between appointments and reappointments.
Okay.
But yeah, I think they belong there.
You convinced me that both appointments and reappointments should not be on the consent agenda by that train of thought. I would support having everything on the consent agenda, and then we could just pull out the ones that we care about.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true.
How could you explain that again? Could you explain that again, what you propose?
Everything's on the consent agenda, so we can take one vote and go home, unless we pull things out of it.
I understand.
I'm kidding.
The point you're, I know. I'm glad to hear you. The point you're making, you know, I get it, but I think there are many routine items, wouldn't you agree, like approving minutes?
The purpose of appointments. I mean,
But
if they require scrutiny, get them out of the consent agenda. Whether they're appointments or reappointments, take them out of the consent agenda. They require scrutiny.
Well, I think
scrutiny, then I mean, you know, one of the other functions of it is, I mean, the school committee uses a consent agenda all the time. I guess they don't do many appointments, but the effect of a consent agenda is you need to come knowing exactly what you, you know, are prepared to do on each appointment. You need to do your homework. And I think everyone in the council does that. But that's what a consent agenda would force us to do. So if there is a problem, we pull it off for the purpose of discussion.
And then we could always just consider putting the reappointments on the consent agenda and the appointments together, and somebody could say move them as a group if there's nothing contentious.
Exactly.
Well, it's essentially what we do now. What we do now, the purpose of a consent agenda, of course, is it makes it pro forma. Mm-hmm. And I think to Councilor O'Donnell's point, I'm trying to think the last time we parsed out an appointment. And it's been a long time.
Years.
Yeah. And to that point, I mean, I think we're just, at this point, we're splitting hairs. The purpose, it is to streamline the meeting. Mm-hmm. It's not to diminish anything in its relevance or importance. And
then perhaps what we want to say is the reappointments and the appointments that come with a positive recommendation can go on the consent agenda. If one comes back without a positive recommendation or no recommendation, it would go on the regular agenda. That way, if the committee that reviewed it thinks there's a need for scrutiny, they can forward it to get scrutinized further. If they don't, then it goes on the, because if they get a positive recommendation, they just go on the consent agenda. That way they'd be predetermined where they were going by the committee that reviewed them.
Well, that's
compromise.
Well, that's essentially, as I was understood it, this is just to refer them to committee for recommendation, so they wouldn't be coming to us with a recommendation, except from the mayor, who would be the appointing authority. So
only with referrals?
No,
this is for when they come back.
It's both. That's why.
Okay.
The last item in the consent agenda is when an appointment has not received a recommendation from the standing committee pursuant to charter, a vote within the consent committee shall be equivalent to motion to refer it. Otherwise, it shall be equivalent to approval. So, ACDC.
For the purpose of discussion, should we have all referrals on the consent agenda? Just because those typically don't garner much discussion, and that might help streamline things a bit.
We frequently do on referrals move them as a group, and I'm trying to think the last time we had a debate on referrals.
But the consent agenda always allows for that.
Right.
Items could be placed on it. And the only thing is that a motion to refer something to a particular committee, in theory, shouldn't be predetermined. That should be a motion that comes from the floor. I think we have matters that we know are going to go to transportation and parking, so our administrative assistant helps us by putting up that recommendation. Whereas an appointment, we know by charter, it must be referred to committee. Do you know what I mean? I think there's that distinction,
no choice.
Too.
Further discussion on this item. Guess a roll call on this one would probably help, huh?
What's on the
floor right now? Councilor Adams' amendment to strike appointments, not reappointments, but to strike appointments from the consent agenda. Is that correct?
Did I have
that
right?
That's it. Okay. So, Pam, would you do a roll call, please?
Okay, can I just ask a question? Because I don't see reappointments here. Are we assuming that reappointments fell under appointments on the consent agenda?
Yeah.
So now you're taking them out.
Now we're making a distinction before. Councilor O'Donnell basically considered all, and that was his point, I think, that all appointments, reappointments, or appointments are of equal weight. Okay.
Where am I? Oh, boy, it's going to take me 2 years to get that one figured out.
You got it.
Look,
what's going on
here,
the agenda?
Here, let me make life easier. I'll withdraw the motion. It was going to lose 8-1.
I wasn't talking about that.
No, it's okay. It's 10 o'clock. The motion's going to lose 8-1. I'll withdraw it.
Is it going on the agenda or isn't it? Is it a consent or isn't it?
It's
with a roadmap.
Well, it's withdrawn. Okay. So
my consent.
So we've already passed the other amendments proposed, the two from Councilor Adams and the others presented by Councilor O'Donnell. Now we are referring the committees. Councilor O'Donnell.
Did we vote on the actual amendment?
No.
Oh, I don't think we did.
Yes, we did. And I started with a new amendment right after.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yeah, we did. Yes. Hours ago. But
so I moved to refer this to
Ordinance and city joint ordinance city council meeting.
15.
Tuesday, December 15th.
Yeah.
What is it precisely you're referring?
I am referring.
Our rules.
Well, we can.
Committee.
Don't say that.
I'm referring section 2.
Can we do that? We're going to split it.
Can we refer?
Send the whole rules, right, because.
We can refer the whole thing.
It's not code that it's just that part that we're looking at.
You can.
Yeah, I refer the whole thing.
Second.
Second.
All right, a second to refer. Back to ordinance. Discussion.
Encore.
Under referral.
I would just like an opinion from the solicitor or somebody about whether we, how we deal with it when it comes back. We may have to suspend rules or to do.
Yeah.
I would want an agreement about that sort of consensus, maybe.
We could suspend rules and take two readings.
Sure we could.
Yep. Okay, so get a reading from the.
Sure.
Okay.
Yes, if we could ask the solicitor if it will require, once it's been referred out of council after the first reading, once back to the floor, we have to do two readings on it, really if it's a significant change. Or does this meet the threshold of significant change, and if that rule even applies to us?
Okay.
Okay.
Or just do two readings anyway.
Because we rule as the earth and no one defies.
Move the question.
All those in favor for the referral, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay. All right. Item B under orders and ordinances 14.317, order in order of taking to accept Scanlon Avenue as a public way. And this is second reading.
Move second reading.
Second.
Discussion. Roll call, please. Sorry.
That's okay. Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
That passes in second reading. Item C, number 15.539, order to that persons are hereby declared elected to such offices as a result of November 3rd, 2015 biennial municipal election.
Waive readings. So
come on.
Move second reading.
So, okay, motion's been seconded. Discussion on this. Corrections. Okay. Roll call, please.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
All right, that passes in second reading. We are elected. Now comes my favorite, my personal favorite, item D, 15.5220. This is the ordinance pertaining to glass to ensure the structures exempt from review minimally maintain the existing amount of glass on street-facing facade. Second reading.
Move second reading.
Second.
Further discussion. Roll call, please.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Passes in second reading. Item E, 15.522. This is the ordinance pertaining to complete streets policy. Second reading. I'll accept a motion.
We already did,
we already did that.
Yeah, actually, I'm sorry, we did do that. Wow.
Yeah, we did that.
We blistered through this.
What's a winger? What's a winger?
15.523, the ordinance regarding winter parking regulations. This is a first reading, and this is as amended by City Council on November 19th. This is upon the recommendation of Transportation Parking. An ordinance of the City of Northampton, Massachusetts, providing that the Code of Ordinances of Northampton, Massachusetts be amended, be it ordained that section number 312-31 of the Code of Ordinances of the City of Northampton, winter parking regulations. The amendment says, during the winter parking season, no person shall park any vehicle during a snow emergency on any street and then or municipal parking lot between the hours of 12:01 a.m. is proposed to be added to the ordinance. Right? You're looking quizzical. I thought.
There aren't any changes.
There aren't any changes.
Isn't the mayor supposed to weigh in on this?
Yes.
This is the one that I oppose, and it passed very narrowly in transportation parking. And so last time we postponed it till today.
Right. More information. So that's what happened.
Have we heard the mayor's opinion or discussion on this at all?
I haven't personally. I didn't ask, but yeah.
How does everyone want to proceed? Postpone it for one more meeting if you wanted to do that.
Not snowing yet.
Well, I think.
Otherwise, I'll vote it down.
We wouldn't be able to do two votes and it'd just carry over, right?
Well, this is something that's probably important not to carry over, given the fact that it'll be January, be the thick of winter by the time it becomes an issue.
So this is a first reading?
Yeah.
So we could take a first reading and vote it down in a second reading?
Exactly.
Okay.
Any discussion on the point?
Yeah, well, you don't have to.
Is it better?
No, we could see if it passes.
Yeah, I'll accept a motion.
Move first reading.
Second.
Discussion, Councilor O'Donnell.
I think if I'd like to make a motion to amend this, if we're going to vote on it, we need at least a minimum amendment to this to provide an exception. Right now, this says during a snow emergency, you essentially can't park in any municipal lot. And representing Ward 3, I think it's probably a problem for a lot of people who live downtown or close to downtown. So if you look in the code under Section B, there are two exemptions, and I would like to add a third one, which is just the Armory Street lot. Which is intended, I think.
It is the snow emergency lot.
I second that.
Okay, thank you.
Motion's made and seconded to add the Armory Street lot as an exception. Discussion on the amendment. All those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Oh, I'm sorry. What was your finger?
Question.
Sure.
My recollection from the Transportation and Parking Commission meeting was that this was designed because of Sheldon Field issues, is that correct?
That's what I recall.
And others, but, yeah.
And others?
Precipitated by Sheldon, the park and ride, yeah.
Okay, all right, that just helps me remember.
And for consistency, correct.
Sorry.
The mayor did speak to this.
Spaces and lots the same.
The mayor did speak to this point.
Yeah.
Spoke to the point, the intent and purpose here, as opposed to, I think the amendment somewhat addresses what Councilor O'Donnell's concern was, so. All right, so let's go back to the amendment. What's, all those in favor of the amendment, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Any other fingers raised? Okay, now back to the order. Any further discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Spector?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge? Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
No.
That passes in first reading and to be revisited. And any questions or concerns, I would suggest advance them to the proper department heads or whatever to see how that goes by the next and final reading. item G, 15.524, this is an ordinance revising section 312-117 of the schedule, excuse me, 16 handicapped parking spaces on Kai Street. Second reading.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion's made and seconded. Any discussion? Roll call, please. Is it?
Councilor Spector?
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Last but not least, H 15.525, and by the way, that passed in the second reading. This is an ordinance revising section 312-45. This is designation of parking spaces. Second reading, accept a motion.
Second.
Discussion? Roll call, please.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Councilor Shara?
Yes.
Councilor Spector?
Yes.
So just to let you all know that at the final meeting of this session, of course, because of our current rules require acceptance of minutes and also approval of minutes of committees that have not convened or will have not convened by the time we meet to approve their own minutes, we're actually going to create little special sessions in the next council meeting where, for instance, Ed Lieu will convene briefly to accept their last minutes so that we, in turn, in the finality of these rules, accept them and so put that on your heavy schedule, and there'll be some other house cleaning procedures, just to give you a heads up. Enrollment committee's got everything they need to sign. I think we're all set. I'll accept a motion to adjourn.
Yes.
Yes?
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn. Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any extensions? Okay. Thank you all very much. Once again, thank you.